Well, Gerry, are we on? Are we on? One, two, three, testing.
Yes, we're on the air.
Well, Gerry, I have to say this. I see McBlain's latest CDs. They sound a bit crackly.
Well, that's because it's analogue.
And what the fuck is analogue beside Anna Dale Embankment or what?
No, it means that they're old recordings.
Anyway, Gerry, that bastard McBlain has been taking a mickey out of all of us politicians for over 21 years. So what are we going to do about them?
Well, what do you want done to him?
Well, what about a wee warning?
Want a warning shot to the back of the head?
Well, I suppose that would do for a start, yes. Or maybe the front with any luck. Anyway, I suppose we'll have to pull that chair up and have a wee listen to this.
Well, now, gentlemen, we'll move swiftly on to the paramilitary views. I want all your political views on paramilitary groups. Now, first of all, I would like to ask you, Mr. Paisley, what about you?
Sorry, Mr. Cole, but I'm not that way inclined. I don't want the ibs.
No, I'm not referring to that. I mean about the organisations.
Oh, well, I support... sorry about that. I support all Protestant organisations. And you... Jesus Christ, sorry about that. The UVF, the Ulster Defence Association, the Protestant Acts. Gerry, you better stop that.
Mindy Petey, I swear to God, it's not me, honest. I swear to God, it's not...
You're a fucking liar. Your face is going purple for fuck's sake trying to hold it in. And as I was continually saying, the Ulster Freedom Fighters and any other Protestant groups in Northern Ireland, because they have all supported my cause in Ulster. Gerry, I'll slap your fucking face if you do that again. They supported my cause in Ulster and will continue to do so. When I ask for their support and... Not only that, if a civil war were to break out tomorrow, these organisations would be in the front line fighting for their country.
Now, we've had information that you, Mr. Paisley, collect funds for paramilitary groups. I mean, you've even got to skip outside your church on a Sunday afternoon.
Yes, I do donate some sort of funds to some groups, to which I'm not going to mention to you, Mr. Colt. And the skips are there because of my congregation don't put in it. They'll go fucking in it. It's as simple as that.
Now, Mr. Fitt, do you support any paramilitary groups? Well, I've got away from a few crust grabbers to support in it. I think that's enough.
I don't know about that, Gerry, if they're your kids or mine.
Will they look like me?
Well, fuck, they must have a squint in their eye or something.
Now, Tom King, are the RUC going to get tough again this year if loyalists behave in the way they did last year?
Of course they are. In fact, they will be even tougher. Oh dear, sorry about that, Mr. King. As I was saying before, I was rudely interrupted. Because they know what my... Mr. Cole, I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to use your lavatory here.
Yes, I have to go to the toilet. That's ridiculous. How was that NDMB last night?
Well, now... Mr. Paisley is making his way to the toilet there. So we'll just continue on there. Mr. Keane, what were you saying there?
Well, as I was saying before, I said bloody rudely interrupted. Now we know the culprit has been bloody farting all afternoon. Of course they're going to be tougher. In fact, they will be very tough because they know what might happen. Hopefully it won't. But they will be at the ready to snare anyone who breaks the law. I mean, nobody can go around breaking the law and doing as they please without being apprehended. They're going to be apprehended by the RUC, and they're going to be dealt in the most severe manner.
Yes, well, while Mr. Paisley's away to the lavatory there, we'll have to go to Gerry Fitt. Gerry Fitt, what do you reckon?
I think that's sad. It is disgraceful. That fighting is ridiculous. I mean, it's fucking smelt the place. I can barely stand this here. I'm fucking sitting here and I'm holding my nose and everything here. It's absolutely shit.
Well, we're not worried about Mr. Paisley blowing air between his arse, Mr. Fitt. What is your reaction again on these marches?
Well, I reckon that the 12th parade should be banned altogether. They shouldn't allow these 12th parades to go on if it's going to create so much violence.
Well, I see Mr. Paisley's coming back again.
Jesus Christ, fucking listen to Tom came and make you fucking shite.
Now, Mr. Paisley, now that the disease has made its appearance all round Britain, and the greater part of the world as well. Do you use a condom now that the risks of infection are higher?
No, my wife Eileen doesn't like the smell of burning rubber. And not only that, the wife used to use the cream out of them for to make the tea, and oddly enough, the taste is not the same. But I wouldn't drink it anymore. It's rotten.
Gerry Fit, do you use a condom?
A condom? Is it a fancy name for a cigar? What? Is that cigars?
No, you bin lid. It's a form of contraception, or a sheath, which is placed over your middle wicket.
Middle wicket? What the fuck are you talking about here, Mr. Cole? I don't fucking play cricket, you daft.
I think Mr. Fitz not psyched in here. He's up the left again, or up the falls. John Hume, do you use a condom?
No, it's against our religion to use any form of contraception, so I just go bareback.
Oh, see about that. Now, Mr. Paisley, what about you?
Well, Mr. Hume talks about going bareback. I mean, the times have changed. Mr. Hume, because I can remember the time your wife was playing a bite with a rolling pin, and you never got a look in.
Mr. Paisley, leave Mr. Hume alone. How do you think we can stop this disease spreading?
Well, I say this here, Mr. Cole, and I mean it sincerely. To keep Margaret Thatcher and her other cronies locked up for a start. And I also say, remove the firing pins from these fruit merchants. And let us all keep our naughty bits cleaner too. Did you hear that, Gerry?
Oh, there's nothing naughty about me, Mr. Paisley. Or my naughty bit. There's nothing dirtier about me either.
Well, it's your face leaves a lot to be desired. It's as well you don't get fucking AIDS through ugliness when Gerry Fit be ringed with it.
Right now, Dr. Paisley, we're going to talk about the politicians' worries over the BSE in cattle. Now, we're all fucking horrified by it. But Dr. Paisley, this should be quite close to your heart because you obviously represent the farmers and all the rest of it. The farmers in Northern Ireland are getting into an all-time low as far as exporting beef. So what can we do to help them?
Ignore them. No, I'm only joking. I say that the British government are to blame for this disaster. They should lift the ban on beef in Northern Ireland. I mean, my wife Eileen doesn't take the beef anymore. Fuck. That's not what I heard. I heard you divert it, you lucky big bullock. Mr. Fit, let me tell you something. You'll be fucking paying a visit to the dentist if you don't shut your trap.
I was only joking, for God's sake. There's no need to get your knickers in a twist.
Right, as I was saying, my wife doesn't touch it anymore.
I take it you're talking about the beef still, Doctor?
Yes, I am. Don't be trying to be funny. Even the daughter, Rhonda, doesn't take the beef anymore either.
Well, Sammy Wilson could tell you otherwise.
Look, Beardy Buck, you better shut your mouth, son. And you wouldn't know what fucking beef tasted like anyway, not unless you'd done an armed robbery to buy it.
Right, come on now, Dr. Paisley. Has the BSE scaring beef, has it affected the troubles in Northern Ireland in any such case?
Yes, of course it has. It's going to bring about unemployment. And I think there's more troubles with the ceasefire because farmers are struggling to make ends meet. They have to take on the trade of Gerry Adams and do a few armed robberies to get by.
Mr. Adams, your response?
Excuse me. I don't do such things. I do, however, count the takings. And that's not the issue here. We are talking about someone's livelihood.
You're a livelihood, all right. Underlined livelihood.
Say no more about that.
Right now, well, Dick Spring, how can we help these poor farmers?
Well, I've never heard of a poor farmer, to be honest with you, but I think the people in North should mix their cattle with the people in the South.
Holy fuck, listen to this. We don't want fucking Catholic cows in Northern Ireland. And we don't want to start to interbreed cows either.
But it's going to help the farmer.
Fuck the farmers! They don't want Republican cattle. They want British beef only. Now you just have to listen to Dickie Spring. He wants Protestants and Catholics from both sides of the border to get together. Now he wants fucking cows. The next thing he'll want is Catholic brains transplanted into Protestant bodies. That's not going to happen, Dickie.
Right now, come on, Dr. Paisley, settle it down a bit. John Hume, will there be help for the farmers?
Well, what we need to do is get dialogue between all farmers from all sections of the community. We need togetherness to defeat this serious problem.
fuck's sake. You sound like an advert for the Royal Irish Regiment, for God's sake. Mr. Hume, can you not change your same old rhetoric, son? Because that's all we get, don't you?
Right now, Gerry Adams, how serious is the problem with beef in Northern Ireland?
Well, it's very serious. I mean, I have to go to the Republic of Ireland to get a pound of fucking sausages at the cost of one punt. And it cost me £40 in petrol to get there. Mind you, it's not so bad when you've hijacked someone else's car. But the problem is very worrying. And I think, like Dick Spring says, we need integrated fields for your cattle.
Sir Patrick Mayhew, what can the government do to help the farmers and help them in this crisis?
Nothing. I think it's a case of waiting until all the farmers in Northern Ireland start committing suicide.
You don't care about the hard-working farmers. All you're worried about is John Major's backside, if it's clean or not. Isn't that right?
Right now, Gerry Fitt, there have been a lot of culls lately. Is that the right way forward?
Well, I haven't heard of any killings.
No, I mean culls, Mr. Fitt. Culls as in slaughter of young or old cattle.
Oh, fuck, sorry. I thought you were talking about killings there. Cullens or whatever the fuck. Well, the problem is down to that there. It has to be done, mind you. How many people in Northern Ireland have died as a result of BSE? I mean, I haven't heard of any.
Right, well, the Reverend William McCrea, you're very fond of your beef. Should it be banned in Northern Ireland or not?
Well, let me say, I don't think it should be banned from the north of Ireland, but the south of border should be banned, because I believe the Republicans are coming over the border and deliberately infecting our cows.
Why, have you noticed something strange about your wife or what?
Don't you fucking say anything about my...
Come on now, gentlemen, sort that out.
Come on now, for fuck's sake, settle it.
I'll slap his face.
Hold on, Mr. Paisley, this is my fucking right. Mr. Adams, you say anything about my wife again, I'll stick my boot in her beardy bollocks. Great, gentlemen, come on. That's the end of the issue.
Right, Mr. Fitt, what do you think of the scandal of the boys' home of Kincora House?
Well, I had a fucking great time. I think it's a lot of dirty bastards in there. Yeah, a lot of dirty...
What, the boys?
No, the so-called MPs. He went in there to flog her lugs. I mean, I'm not afraid to say that the Rochdale MP, Mr. Cyril Smith, was in the grounds of this house and inside the fucking building too, giving out pounds of beef to these youngsters. But I'll tell you what, I wouldn't fancy the fat bastard sitting in my face anyway.
Now, we've managed to bring in a gentleman who was bum-chumming in Kincora House all those years ago. So in order to protect his identity and his bollocks, we're calling him Mr. X. Well, Mr. X, how many boyfriends did you meet in Kincora House?
What do you mean, by mate? You mean porking them?
No, I mean friends.
Well, they say, you know, whenever I went into the house, they all ran away from me whenever they saw me. But I was always there. I always caught up on them.
Every bit of when you caught up on him, you bastard, you should have been still sucking her dummies and running about in her fucking knees.
They were sucking more on dummies than I got to fucking hear them.
You fucking heavy bastard, you're right.
Now hold on, I'll stick my boot in that bastard's face, Mr. Cole. You better get him fucking out of here.
Right, now hold on, now hold it. Now, Mr. X, what have you got to say?
I wasn't a pervy bastard. I was a lucky fucking bastard.
Now, Lord Fitt, what have you got to say about this terrible experience?
Well, I think it's fucking ridiculous. I mean, that perverted cunt shouldn't be in here. I mean, interfering with youngsters is totally out of fucking question. Get him out the fuck, Mr. Cole, if you know what's good for you.
Right, well, just gonna have to get a bit of... Oh, for fuck's sake.
I'm sorry about that, I didn't mean that.
Now, hold on now. Lord Fitt, you saying you had a terrible experience with a 9-inch vibrator?
Yes, I did. I put it in a juke shop, and I'll not mention any names. And I attached the vibrator on the 12-volt car battery. As soon as I put the switch on, it knocked 7 of my fucking teeth out. So it was running a bit gumless.
At this stage and point, we're going to invite our inside audience to pose their questions to our politicians. Yes, that gentleman in the white jumper there at the far side there, what's your name?
My name's Blagga, and I'm married with two kids. They're a two cheeky bastards, many. But my problem's a wife, she wants another cheeky bastard, another child, and I don't want to give her one. And I want Mr. Bellamy to tell me what to do about it.
Well, if you'd like to send your wife round to me, I'll give her one or two.
Look, pretty bollocks, I don't fucking... I turn egg over knock his fucking balls on, Mr. Cole.
Well, I was only joking, honestly. I was only offering her a spare set of jewels for God's sake.
Right, I want Dr. Paisley to tell me.
Well, if your wife
wants another child, why don't you adopt the child? Sure, my wife's a fucking alcoholic, and our house is coming down with rats, fucking wallpapers hanging off, and I bat like fuck on the Gigi's.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, you've got what it takes to be a foster parent.
Oh, fuck, that's magic, that's brilliant. Right now, since your problems were sorted out, Blackie, right, well, we'll move on quickly here. Right, that gentleman in the green jumper, what's your sexual problem, or what problem do you suffer from?
My name's Willy Wonka, and it seems to be my problem, a wee Willy.
What, that you've got only a wee prick, or what?
Yes, it's very small, but it hurts like fuck. I'm just wondering if there's anything I could do, like maybe get an extension on the end of it. And I would like to ask Mr. Alex Higgins about that one.
Well, I think, I'm gonna get a drink. I think, your problems are my son. You sound like a fucking frog. And, hold on a little. Oh god, fuck, that's nice. You do, you sound like a frog and you're just using your prick as an excuse, or maybe you're swallowing half your prick. As for extensions, the only extension I know you can get is an extension for a snooker cue. Gives an Orby snort that coke. Oh, sorry, an Orby drink that coke.
Wait, Lord Fit, do you know anywhere where you could get an extension?
Aye, you can. If you go up to a wee bar in West Belfast, they have an extension from 11 to 1 o'clock every fucking night of the day. I'm talking about an extension, for fuck's sake, for your penis. Sure, I don't need an extension for my penis. My well's bigger than Sir John's.
Mr. Fitter, how do you know this to be true? How do you know your prick? Beg your pardon, I'm choking here. How do you know your prick is...
You're choking on my fucking prick, the thought of it, you bastard, you...
No, how do you know your prick is bigger than mine? Mine's fucking far bigger than yours.
Well, your wife must be a fucking mad bastard then, Mr. Heyman. Like, I give it over, Jerry, there's no need for that. I'm only fucking Reagan, for fuck's sake. Well, it's not funny now. Ronald Reagan, have you ever had any sexual problems?
Well, I can't remember.
What, having sex or having a problem?
Well, I can't recall that incident either.
Well, what sort of problems have you encountered? What about Nancy?
Nancy? Nancy who?
Your fucking wife, you must be going fucking berserk here. You're going fucking loopy.
Oh, well, Nancy, Nancy sits in cactuses because she likes plenty of pricks.
Oh, I see. She must have a crutch on her like a fucking teabag.
Well, I can't recall that incident.
Oh, for fuck's sake, we're getting fucking nowhere here. Right now, do you think the size of your manhood matters in fulfilling sexual pleasure for women, Gerry Fit?
Well, you've heard the old saying, it's not the length, but the quality that matters. So I don't think it matters about the size of your porky.
You're only saying that, Mr. Fit, because you've only got a wee chopper.
Have a fuck. Wait till you fucking look at this here, bastard. Can I fucking show you that? Look at the size of that there, bastard. There, you put six holes in it, you can play the fucking sash on it.
Jesus Christ, look at the size of that there. My God, you can use that for a fucking baseball bat.
You'll begin to crush your fucking head. You don't fuck up, cool.
Jesus Christ. Now, Mr. Fit, I'm not stand fat. There's no need for that fucking cheek. I was only complimenting you on the size of it. Now, Prince Charles, do you think the size of your manhood matters to the female, in some cases the male?
Well, I wouldn't fancy 6 or 7 inches been put up my ass. No, I don't think the larger the better. I think it's all down to sensitivity and quality.
Sir John, do you agree with that?
Certainly not. As the ex-chief cause of the IUC, I had to worry about the size of all of my officers. As far as I was concerned, the bigger my officers, the better.
Sir John, we're talking about the pricks here.
Well, none of my constables were pricks, Mr. Cole, let me remind you. They were qualified and dedicated members of Her Majesty's forces. There's no pricks in the IUC.
Well, let me tell you, Mr. Herman. There's more pricks in the IUC than there is in a fucking cactus plant like that. Come on, be serious. There is pricks in it.
Right, now, give it over, Mr. Paisley. Now, Barney McGuigan, do you think the size of your prick matters or your manhood or what?
Well, I don't know about that. My wife gives a great laugh at the size of my worm. In fact, it's that small she asked me to use my fucking baby finger instead.
Fuck, I thought I had problems, Jesus Christ. Right now, Dr. Paisley and a few others have wrote and produced a record which they're going to sing, and
They're going to do it now for us, I think. And it's going along the theme tune of Little Donkey. I'm sure all the kids and all the rest of it remember that. And this is, of course, for our kids' ear holes. You'll really like this one. Now, Dr. Paisley, I'd like you to sing this as from 1, 2, 3.
I'm a donkey, I'm a donkey, so the girls tell me. It's big enough and hard enough to knock down a fucking tree. Bring out those hearse tonight, Bethlehem, Bethlehem. Follow their hairy stars tonight, Bethlehem, Bethlehem. I'm a donkey, I'm a donkey that would fit anywhere. I'll put my donkey into anything that has got some hair. Bring out those hearse tonight, Bethlehem, Bethlehem. Follow their hairy stars tonight, Bethlehem, Bethlehem. I'm a donkey, I'm a donkey with a big set of balls. I'm not a scared to hug my donkey, even up the fucking falls. So bring out those hearse tonight, Bethlehem, Bethlehem. Follow their hairy stars tonight, Bethlehem, Bethlehem. I'm a donkey, I'm a donkey, that much is true. And if you want to feel my donkey, it'll cost you.
Fucking marvellous. That was really great. There, I had the old feet tapping and everything there.
Oh, fuck. Sorry about that. That was great, Mr. Paisley. Really. Oh, yes. Well, it took me a long time to write that particular song, and the words really hammer at home how I feel about the prostitutes and all the rest of it in this country.
Right. Well, the great wee number, Dr. Paisley, and obviously it's going to get the number one. Sir John Herman, what did you think of that little number?
Well, I thought it was a very, very degrading song that inflicts both pain and sorrow to all women alike, to associate the like of hers with Bethlehem is totally disgusting. And I think if the three wise men had heard this song, they'd each stick their frankincense golden mare up Ian Paisley's fucking arsehole.
And let me tell you something, I'll punch the fucking head of you, black bastard.
Mr. Paisley, give it over you, sir.
Knock my fuck out of bastard. No need for that, it took me months to write that.
Right, now give it over, sir, John, and get up again. Fucking way, I gotta dig my jaw for fuck all that.
Fucking tell you, Mr. Herman, you'll push your luck, I'll kill you, black bastard.
Right now, give it over, Ian, for fuck's sake. Right now, make way here, for we've got Her Majesty the Queen in. Excuse me, ma'am, do you have sex often?
I don't have sex often with the people in Northern Ireland because they're the most deprived people in the whole of Britain.
I always knew it. The Queen's a bit of a gag. Hey, fuck.
I said I don't have sex, you silly finian deaf bastard.
Hey, I'm not the fucking hairy orange bastard. You
right now, the fucking party has given it over. Fuck's a given it over. That's the Queen.
I don't give a fuck who it is. I'm not taking a lip from her because she's a crown in her fucking head. Right, excuse me. Excuse me, ma'am. Any more of your language and I'll throw you out the fuck. Right now, Florence, you wanted something there. Fucking right, today. I'm looking for a bit of sex, and I want it right now. He's going to fucking give it to me.
Certainly not me. I don't want the fucking dose of your crabs.
Certainly not me. I wouldn't touch it with the fucking bars, Paul, you know. There's no way I'm going to touch you, because the crabs and the fucking lobsters will be hanging right out of your underwear. There's nowhere I'm going to eat. I'll end up getting knocked the fuck so when I want to go home. Well, what about you, Gerry? You look as though you're well hung, you're well geared. Hey, come on, man, I'm your fucking man. Excuse me, this is a live recording, you, so you just can't fucking lie in the middle of blood. So fucking what? That's right, you fucking tell him. So what? Wait, hold on.
Till when they get these fucking pigs to influence. They've been fucking after this for I don't know fuck's sake, Jerry.
Where's up?
Fucking ways up. They knock it fucking ways into the birthday. Right, come on, Florence, on the fucking floor there. Right, come on, Jerry. Get it in. Get it in, Jerry. Fuck. Oh, jeez, fuck, it's a bit tight there. You're up the fucking arse, sick. Oh, fuck. Oh, jeez.
Mr. Cole, excuse me, you're going to allow this sort of perversion to carry on.
Fucking right, Ian. This is educational, Sir John. Now, shut up. Right, Florence, that's it. I'm in there. I'm in there, Florence. Oh, God. Oh, it's better. Oh, it feels better. How's it feel? Oh, fuck, Jerry, that's great. I never had a finion up me before. No, I for fuck's sake, this is marvellous. Oh, Florence. Oh. Oh, you're some upgrade. Right, Jerry, hurry up and get it over with, for fuck's sake. Would anyone else like a fucking bang at Florence while we're all waiting here?
The fuck are you yapping for fuck's sake? My cock's not that big.
What are you yapping for, yappy cunty? Right now, come on, Dr. Paisley, what about you? Would you like a
fucking sure I'm not touching that. You must be fucking joking, Mr. Cole. You stuck anything in that, you be pulling out fucking nothing again.
What about you, Charles Hawkey?
I think I'll just spectate because my right hand's engaged at the minute, you know. Oh, for fuck's sake. Talking of which, Jerry, you finished it.
Oh, fuck. Oh, that was great, Flint. Oh, that was marvellous. Oh, fuck, I'm naked. That was a queer bit of gear, boy. Lovely. Hey, thanks very much for... Here, where the fuck do you think you're going? I'm about to miss you to you. Ah, fucking see you or not? There's no way. Where do you think you're fucking going? You better pay me before you go and sit in your fucking hole. Oh, fuck. Mercy, you went. Give us a fucking 10 out of day, Ridley. Hey, you dirty fucking hey. Where's that fucking money? Fuck's sake. Hey, you dirty bastard. You stick up your ears.
Well, to finish off tonight's discussions, ladies and gentlemen, we went round a great few of our celebrities and we've discussed spitting sex into the in-depths of the sea, you would say. We went right to the bottom with it. Well, to finish it off, we'd like to ask a few of our politicians who they would like most in their bed. Dr. Paisley, I would like to ask you, who would you like to have in your bed if you, of course, weren't married?
Well, I would like to have the likes of Marilyn Monroe in my bed.
Fuck, you better start fucking digging.
I'll start fucking digging. Oh, I'm only joking, you. I'll knock your bollocks and fuck's sake. You bastard, you'll knock the fuck out of you.
Right, come on now, give it over, for fuck's sake. Oh, for fuck's sake, I'm sorry about that. I think you're fucking shitting us up.
Give us that fucking spray out. Oh, you're a dirty fucking bastard, you are.
Hey, you fucking give me a dig in a grove for fuck all. I was only messed up bait about Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah, bastard. That's my fucking idol.
Jesus Christ, I've never came across an ending like this in all my fucking life. Anyhow, we're going to end it off there, ladies and gentlemen. This is John Cole thanking you all for tuning in and listening again to Spittin' Tapes. And we hope to hear from you very, very soon. From me, good night and God bless.
Broken up from school and waist and combed your wavy hair.
That'll be a first.
Sammy, are you contemplating going out somewhere? The word out on the street is that you may not be around.
Well, I'd be glad to hear that.
Put that camera down.
I mean, I don't know what the fuck made him do that in the first place. One about his bollocks hanging out.
Now in some foreign land you may do as you please.
Just write to some.
And if it's done in private, then begging he'll be pleased.
You're fucking right, I'm pleased. You're right.
If you and Sharon Rivers plan once more to let it flow.
Well, that pull the tits of her, boy. There's some tits on her.
Oh, Sammy. Would you be wise to go?
Oh, yes, go like a rabbit.
Now getting back to nature may just be a better way. But heaven photos taken is just after I have to see.
The water's very chilly indeed.
And it won't be long before the negatives get around.
Oh, and I've got the three missing ones.
Oh, Sammy.
Put the camera up your arse.
Please put that camera down.
Look at gobshite.
The DUP are raging at the sight of Sammy's bum.
He might have wasted it first.
He could have blown his chances, the party's faithful stunned. And if they had some guns, they would have run him out of town.
Well, I can lend him a couple of guns. No problem.
Oh, Sammy.
Hold the guard.
Don't take your knickers down.
You dirty fucky.
Oh, Sammy. Don't take your knickers down.
Oh, you dirty cat.
Right, Sammy, come on. Pull them underpants up.
Run around get your bollocks hanging out.
Are they berries under your arse up?
Aye, chuck berries.
Go and get that arse of yours scrubbed, you dirty beast.
Leave my own first fuck, sir. You're jealous a whole lot, eh?
Gentlemen, welcome to this edition of Blind Hate, and your host for tonight is the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, Marjorie Mowlam.
Welcome, Madam, and your host for tonight's edition of Blind Hate, the show in which we try to pair up two of our lovely local politicians in an executive partnership. Let me introduce you to three gorgeous politicians on tonight's panel. Number one is the extremely cuddly member who stands proud and erect for West Belfast, Gerry Adams. Gerry, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, Mo, care to mail Fialcha?
Sorry there, Gerry, I don't understand any of that old bog language. I hear enough of that from Francie Molloy and Barry McElduff. Remember, this is British television. Can you not speak the Queen's English? I hear Irishmen are very good at using their tongues.
Well, I wouldn't know about that, Mo.
Well, I suppose not, Joe. There might be a bit of a problem there with the old beard rash.
Well, this isn't moving the process forward, is it? Anyway, Mo, I'm currently the MP and Assembly Member from West Belfast. And I'm a full-time revolutionary nationalist.
And a part-time barman. And I hope there will be you'll be pulling a few tonight, rather, Gerry. As you know, we're trying to fix you up with a place on the Stormont Executive tonight. So what position would you like?
Well, I was thinking of a 69.
Oh, you are a saucy boy, Gerry.
I was referring to 1969, when the young people of West Belfast had nothing to do but burn buses and throw bricks at the RUC. I would like to change that by becoming Minister for Sport. As you know, Sinn Féin has already helped make baseball a very popular sport in the area. But as we're a wee bit short of baseball fields, we can only practice on anti-social elements at the moment.
Well, good luck with that, Jerry, and I hope you break a leg.
Well, I'll leave out to Martin McGuinness.
And now contestant number two is a man who is nearly as old as the guns that the LVF decommissioned, and that is, of course, Lord Gerry Finn.
Hello, hi, Dean there, Mo. As you know, I was also an MP for West Belfast until that beardy bastard there stole my seat.
Now, come on, keep it light there, Gerry. We don't want any inflammatory statements.
Inflammatory? That wasn't half as inflammatory as those bastards that burnt my house down. Anyway, I want to be the Minister for Social Security.
Is that because of your deep concern for the unemployed and deprived of Northern Ireland?
No, it's because I want to wipe all those proby bastards off the dole. And they're going to be a bit like Man United last year. One minute they're doing a double and the next they've got fuck off.
A very noble ambition there. Tony Blair will be pleased with your welfare to work policies, I'm sure. But anyway, last but not least, we have all the way from the Maiden City, And that, of course, is Martin Arkafunker McGuinness. You look a little bit nervous there, Martin. Yes, Mo, you see, I'm suffering from PMT, which is pre-ministerial tension. Well, Martin, as well as being an MP and assemblyman, you've also become very accident-prone. I think in that case your wife had better watch out. Well, I don't think there's any chance of that happening. In fact, I've already decommissioned my weapon. I'm firing blanks now. So you've had the old V-word operation. All our operations have the V-word, Mo. V for victory. Come now, Martin. There's no need to get into all that old slanging matches. It doesn't move the process forward. But here, I am not the only talent in one of my family, you know. The other day, my son came home and told me that he had got a part in a school play. I had asked him who he was playing, and he said to me that he was a character who gets married to a dairy woman. Ah, well, I said, perhaps the next time you'll get a speaking role. Careful, or you'll have the Women's Coalition after you.
Bless me, Father, for I have sinned. It's been quite a while since my last confession.
Can't you remember, my son?
Well, put it this way, Father. The last time I went to confession, Celtic were at the top of the league.
Oh, my God. That was a very long time, but I suppose you have been busy with affairs of the state. Tell me, my son, have you any sins to confess?
Yes, Father, I have quite a few. I laughed when I heard Martin McGuinness had broken his leg, and I have had evil thoughts about David Trimble. I was jealous of John Hume when he had won the Nobel Peace Prize.
Just cut out the crap, Gerry. Do you have any juicy sins? Any fornication, for example?
No, Father, but I have been indulging with the old five-fingered widow.
You mean self-abuse? Well, I suppose that's not surprising. After all, Sinn Féin means ourselves alone in English.
I'm sorry, Father. I know it's an awful sin against God, who give us the gift of loving sex.
Well, how often would you do it?
Usually twice a day, sometimes on the desk at Stormont.
Well, you're not the only wanker up there, son. Anyway, your soul is safe. You haven't committed a sin.
How's that, Father?
Well, my son, it's only a sin if you do it more often than your priest. And I can tell you that you have a long, long way to catch up. There's only one thing I would warn you about, though.
And what's that, Father?
Apparently it's supposed to give you an awful stutter.
How can I stop myself doing it, Father?
Well, the next time you're in the assembly and you feel the urge coming on, just focus your eyes on Monica, McWilliams, and start thinking pure thoughts.
Thanks for the tip, Father. I'm sure that'll do the trick all right. By the way, another thing, Father, I recently bought some condoms.
Oh, dear, now that is a real sin. And did you use these evil things?
Yes, Father. When you put the acid into them, it takes 10 minutes to eat through the rubber and set off the firebomb.
Oh, thank God. I thought for a minute that you were using them for immoral purposes. But there's one thing that's bothering me. It's about these punishment beatings. Is there anything you want to tell me?
Now, Father, is this going to move the process forward? I can say quite categorically that Sinn Féin have absolutely nothing to do with it.
Well, there have been certain Sinn Féin members have been observed wearing balaclavas and carrying baseball bats.
Well, I can explain that, Father. First of all, many Sinn Féin members have been unjustly convicted in the Diplock courts and have served long sentences in long cash, as you know. The Brits deliberately kept the central heating up in the H blocks, and as a result, the prisoners find it difficult to adjust to the cold outside world when they are released. So they have to wear balaclavas. And as for the baseball bats, they were a gift from President Clinton when I'd met him. I told him that as a mark of Sinn Féin's respect for American culture, we wanted to set up a baseball league in West Belfast in tribute to our Holy Father, Pope John Paul. We have named the team the Andytown Red Sox. But unfortunately, because the Brits won't provide funding for a baseball field, Sinn Féin members in their balaclavas and thermal underwear are having to instruct young people in the finer points of the game up the street corners and back alleyways. I mean, it's a terrible situation, Father. I mean, how would you like it if you had to take a baseball bat up your back entry
Well, that does have a certain appeal about it, I must admit, but I do get your point. And speaking of President Clinton, I hope he didn't try to lead you astray when you met him.
Well, I was a bit worried when he asked me to write to him and asked if I knew his zip code. I wasn't that well acquainted with the American postal system, so I imagined that the zip code was his personal etiquette for the administration of blowjobs.
It's an easy mistake to make, son, and I know it's time for your penance.
Okay, so what's the damage, Father?
Right, that will be 5 Hail Marys, 10 Our Fathers, and 20 Chucky Our Lads. Plus, you must go to Lourdes and pray for the afflicted.
Fair enough. I'll take Martin McGuinness and try to cure his brittle bone disease.
And Gerry, how about starting to decommission some weapons then?
Oh, so you do believe in fucking miracles?
Welcome tonight to my new show. A little bit of Willie does you good. Tonight I've been asked to sing a new song written by two neighbours of mine in McCrea, Phil McCracken and Fanny McDick. It tells of the deep love that the people of Mid-Ulster have for their Willie. That's the Protestant people, of course. You know, when I told Phil and Fanny that the song had touched me deeply, she told me that I was the first Willie she had touched since her husband had died. Well, I know that tonight Fanny will be cooking her soda farls on the old kitchen range. And I know that husbands all over this wee province would be delighted if their wives' soda farls turned out like Fanny's. So here goes this moving tribute. This is for Phil and Fanny.
What a friend we have in Willie. All our votes we'll give to thee. Get Maginnes decommission. To us you're still our own MP. Now that you're in the Assembly, wishing Finn and the PUP, you've got more hair than David Irvine and a better voice than Daniel O'Dea. When the dock is finally gathered, who will lead the DUP? Sammy Wilson or Peter Robinson? Oh no, we want our wee Willie. What a leader we have been, Willie, when he runs the DUP. We'll have all types of good music, gospel, western and country.
Right, give it up for God and Ulster.
What a friend we have been, Willie. All our votes we'll give to thee. Commission to us, you're still our own MP. Now that you're in the Assembly, wishing Finn and the PUP, you've got more hair than David.
Thank you very much. Praise the Lord.
All right. Right, well, turning to Gerry Adams, I noticed the President gave you a present whenever you had met him.
Yes, and it was a personally engraved baseball bat. He heard how popular the sport was in West Belfast, so I told him that I was looking forward to finding some people I could use a bat on as practice. Oh, sorry, I mean to use the bat to practice baseball, that's what I meant. So the President reminded me of the rules of baseball. Three strikes and you're out. So I said, what about you? Several strokes and you're still in.
Well, sorry to interrupt, Mr. Adams, but I've been given the all clear here for a brief interview with the President. Mr. President, what was the highlight of your visit to Ireland?
Well, first of all, you can all get off your knees. You all know how people can get the wrong end of the stick. Actually, the highlight was meeting your women's coalition led by someone called Monica. But I was on my best behavior. Don't worry about that. She was able to leave without a stain on her character.
And what did you enjoy about Northern Ireland? Was it the beautiful weather we've had here? It usually rains at this time of year, but your visit seems to have brought out the sun.
Well, as Miss Lewinsky might say, one swallow doesn't mean it's summer.
Yes, and any last words to the people of Northern Ireland before you go?
So long, suckers.
Hold on a second. On the issue of so long, suckers, I think the President is getting us all confused with Monica Lewinsky.
Yes, well, thank you very much, Dr. Paisley. We are flat out of time. Good night. Many people have become disillusioned with the medical profession and have turned to practitioners of alternative medicine. Well, tonight we have our new specialist, the Reverend Dr. Ian Kyle Paisley, who will help to attempt to diagnose your problems and offer advice over the airwaves. Dr. Paisley, would you consider yourself a practitioner of alternative medicines?
Indeed I would not. I am a practitioner of Protestant medicine. Just put your faith in the Lord, send a few pounds to me, care of the Martyrs Memorial Church, and a cure will be found.
Right, well, let's see if you can help our first caller who's on the line, a Mr. Trimble from Portadown.
Yes, hello, Dr. Piercy. I have an embarrassing problem. Every time I get excited, my face turns a very bright shade of purple.
Well, Mr. Trimble, I can only suggest that this is a judgment from God, like the mark of Cain. The good Lord has afflicted you with this sign because he disapproves of your betrayal of his chosen people, good Protestant Ulster folk. The only way you can get rid of this is to join the DUP in rejecting this Republican agreement and to shun the Shinner murderers in Stormont. This will cure your facial problems, but I'm afraid to say, Mr. Trimble, I can't do much about that fucking yellow streak down your back.
Yes, well, I think that's good advice for Mr. Trimble. And now I believe we do have a caller from Derry.
And where the fuck's that?
Sorry, I of course meant Londonderry, Dr. Paisley. It's a Mr. Hume.
Hello, Dr. Paisley. I have a very sensitive problem. I'm getting on a bit. I'm a bit overweight, a heavy smoker, and I occasionally have a sip of the devil's buttermilk. I'm still interested in the pleasures of the flesh, though. Every time I try to do it, how can I face it? The altar boy won't go into the confession box. Do you think I should try Viagra?
Well, Mr. Hume, if I could borrow the phrase, I don't give two balls of roasted snow how your erectile dysfunctioning comes about. But again, I would say it's a judgment of the Lord, seeing as you've always been trying to screw the Protestant people of Ulster for years, but now we're saying no, and we really mean no. And let me tell you, whenever I'm Minister for Health on the Executive, there'll be some major changes, let me assure you of that.
Well, I take it then, Dr. Paisley, that you will not be providing prescriptions of Viagra on demand, is that right?
Indeed not. There'll be no general erection in Ulster, and I have a list of people who will not receive Viagra tablets. One, members of Sinn Féin and the SDLP, who already are breeding like rabbits. I'm not going to give them any more encouragement by giving them Viagra tablets. Two, Roman Catholic priests, for reasons too fucking obvious to mention. And I have to say here, I have a petition from 500 altar boys supporting me in this decision. 3, Willie McCrea, that's one Willie that's already big enough for my liking. And besides, it might encourage the wee bastard to record another one of his fucking awful songs. And 4, members of the Alliance Party who have become impotent from spending the last 30 years sitting on the fucking fence. And 5, any Protestants who voted, oh yes.
Right, so who's going to actually receive Viagra tablets then, Dr. Paisley?
Well, basically, all the members and supporters of the Democratic Unionist Party, except, of course, Sammy Wilson, who I have nurtured, or neutered, should I say. I beg your pardon, I was meant to say neutered. Or neutered. I don't know how to say neutered. It's nearly as bad as Ivan Little trying to say phenomenon or phenomenon or whatever it is. But anyway, and Viagra tablets will be given to anyone who asks for it at the Martyrs' Memorial, and it'll be on a first-served, first-come basis. And by the way, Peter Robinson, who, as Harris tells me, needs no extra lead in his pencil, will be organising a campaign to promote Protestant procreation. And I have decided to call it Have a Hard On for Ulster.
Right, well, I hope that all DUP members will rise to the occasion. And our next caller is indeed a Lord Fit from London.
Dr. Paisley, I've got terribly short-sighted in my old age, as you can imagine. I just can't seem to see through these glasses.
Well, why don't you try emptying them first?
Oh, that's better now, Doc. You're a fucking genius.
Well, a bit of a miracle cure there from Dr. Paisley. Well, would you believe, Mr. Paisley, a very popular show indeed tonight. We've actually got another caller on the line, a Mr. Blobby McCartney, I think it is, and he's from County down in Northern Ireland.
Mr. Paisley, Mr. McCartney here, I'm feeling under a terrible weight, and I'm also feeling very, very lonely. What do you think my problem is?
Yes, well, I think you should stop eating the cream buns for a start, Blobby. And on the subject of your loneliness, sure, the last time you had a party, the boys walked out on you. I mean, I tell you what, I don't know what to suggest. I don't even think Mystic Meg could help you out on this one.
Well, unfortunately, they all can't be winners. Of course, Dr. Paisley has cured a few problems tonight, but unfortunately, Blobby McCartney could not be helped out on this particular occasion. Well, that's it. We've come to the end of tonight's programme. Next week, Sammy Wilson will be our guest panellist. He'll be answering the question, is naturism good for you?
Well, all I can say is, thank fuck, it's just a radio show.
Right now, and moving on, we do have Macra Felt's answer to Daniel O'Donnell here, the Reverend William McCrae.
What do you mean? What do you mean by Daniel O'Donnell? Sure, isn't he one of those who sings crap songs and funny high-pitched voices? Who you talk? You fucking insulting me.
Well, I'm sorry, I thought maybe that Daniel O'Donnell was...
Don't fucking insult me, sir. Because let me tell you something, I've sung more records, and I've had more hits in Tennessee. I've had more hits than Gerry Adams has with his 9 mil. So don't give me that fucking shit.
Oh, well, I'm very sorry, Mr. McCrae, for...
You're fucking right, don't insult me. Let me tell you something now. That I have came to this party to greet His Royal Highness. Not to speak to Grizzly Adams.
So, well, I see your point, Reverend McCrae, but I take it you're here to sing to Prince Charles and not to Gerry Adams.
You're fucking right there. The only time that I'll sing to Grizzly Adams will be at his cremation. And I'll be there with a few gallons of petrol to make sure of it. And there's Prince Charles now. I think I'll go over and cheer him up. Hello, Your Highness. How you doing?
Hello, Father McCrae.
Father what? I'll fucking hit you that many times I'll swear you're surrounded, big ears. Actually, it's the Reverend. And as well as being a minister of God and a politician, I'm also a singer of gospel and country music. And it would be a great honour for me to, if you would allow me, that is, to sing you a song on your special birthday.
I do think that's a fine idea, but I must insist that you sing the song to both I and my fellow birthday boy, Mr. Adams.
Come on in, it can't be worse than that fucker ginger spice, can it? Right, I'm going to sing this song, and it's for both of you, Gerry and Charlie. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Your Royal Highness and President Adams. Happy birthday to you.
Well, fuck when he's worse than ginger spice, isn't he?
Aye, you could use that voice to get confessions in Castle Ray. 10 minutes later and I'd confess to killing OJ's wife, for fuck's sake.
You didn't, did you?
Listen, Charlie, do you seriously believe that the IRA, if the IRA had done that, that they would have left all those forensics behind?
Right now, we were here talking about Sammy Wilson's antics earlier on, as you know, but another unionist was in the news for all the wrong reasons. Ken McGuinness, of course, as you all know, Florida, an old age pensioner, because he was making too much noise. Ian Paisley, what do you say about that?
Good on him, because if I heard my neighbours banging, I'd fucking crack up, and I know that.
But when you say banging, do you mean what I think you mean?
Yes, you think right. I'm jealous because I've been celibate for 3 years.
Celibate here and celibate there, Dr. Paisley, I'm only joking you. Now, the big man, Ken, that is, Ken McGuinness, now, he hit this pensioner who was only 5'2" tall and he was age 69. Gerry Fitt, do you think it was fair for Ken McGuinness to flatten him?
No, I do not, because he was in the army and that doesn't give him the right to knock an old bollocks in. I mean, he wouldn't take me on. And I've only got one good eye.
Aye, and that's the eye you shite out of.
Right, now, come on, Dr. Paisley. When you spoke to Ken McGuinness, Dr. Paisley, what did he say about this fight?
Well, Ken said to me that he was confronted by a man who was 6'2", and he was built like a shite house door. And apparently this man had an iron bar in his hands, ready for action. So Ken done a kung fu kick straight up into the man's forehead. Ken McGuinness then did a cartwheel and a somersault and unfortunately missed and collapsed into a heap of shite in the corner. And that's what he told me.
Right, well, Gerry Adams, do you see it like that?
Well, I wasn't there.
No, I mean, do you think that's what really happened?
No, I think Ken McGuinness is watching too much of Steven Seagal's movies. From what I was told, Ken McGuinness got his balls rolled by this poor old pensioner, and, I mean, McGuinness should uphold the law and not break it.
A bit like yourself, Mr. Adams, a good citizen and all the rest of it.
Well, I wouldn't go that far. I mean, I've had my ins and outs. Well, I think you've been more in than out, Mr. Adams, if you don't mind me saying. Aye, in your fucking wife, Paddy.
Right, now, come on, now, Sir Patrick Mayhew, I don't think there's any need for this debate to be lured like that. Right, gentlemen, let's stay on course here. Chris Eubank, do you think Big Bad Ken would make it in the boxing ring?
I don't think this man should be judged until the facts are released. I do, however, know that his opponent was 69 years old. He had a plastic leg, an arm, and he was partially blind.
Well, it could have been worse. He could have had a fucking speech impediment.
Right, now, Willie McCrea, let's bring you in here. Was Big Ken right to flatten this pensioner?
Well, I know Ken's a Christian man, and I'm sure he did not beat this shite out of this pensioner for nothing. He must have been provoked to the extreme because I have known Ken for a long time and I've never known him to lift his hand in his life. That's why his house is so untidy.
Right, now, come on, I thank you for that. But, John Hume, do you believe that Ken McGuinness defended himself in a fair-minded manner?
I really don't know. Both of these men should have had dialogue before going into battle. That's what we need, is communication and a willingness to articulate each other's needs, not going around and knocking each other's fucks in.
Gerry Adams, do you think Ken McGuinness will be brought to court over this incident?
Well, the chances of that happening are equal to Shergar running in the next national. I think Ken McGuinness, personally, should resign. He's brought a disgrace upon his party and upon the people he's meant to represent. And just because he was a member of the Useless Defence Regiment.
Correct you there, Mr. Adams. It was the Ulster Defence Regiment.
Oh, fuck, I didn't know that.
It doesn't give him the right to get away with it. Well, Mr. Adams, let me tell you something. If Ken McGuinness has done wrong, it would never match the wrongdoings of yourself and your sidekicks of the IRA. But I'm not a member of the IRA. But you're the fucking leader of the IRA, aren't you, you bollocks? Right now, gentlemen, come on. I'll slap his fucking...
Right, fuck off me.
Right, come on now, break it up. Leave his beard alone. Come on, I'll stick my boot in him.
There was a time that the only people in Northern Ireland who got stoned on a regular basis were the members of the RUC and the British Army. But today, one of the greatest dangers faced by our young people, apart from C Company and Catholic priests, is the ever-growing drugs menace. Here in the studio, we have some of our most prominent politicians who are going to tell us what they are going to do about the problem. First up is Gerry Adams.
Well, the way I see it is that drugs are a terrible evil. First of all, they distract young people from Sinn Féin's struggle against the occupation of our country by the British state. And secondly, they leave people with less money, which could be spent on fags, sorry Julian, and booze, which are bravely smuggled in by the volunteers of the IRA.
That's right, Gerry. That explains why so many young nationalists have failed to fill in their electoral registration forms. They were too fucking blitzed on marijuana, and I blame the Brits for introducing the supergrass system.
Hold on a minute, Martin or Garfunkel McGuinness. If I can just interrupt Cheech and John here and point out that it was the members of the IRA who were caught up in South America up to their oxters in the old Colombian dandruff.
Well, let me tell you something, Mr. Paisley. That is a slanderous allegation. And you know very well that those three innocent Irishmen went to Colombia to indulge in their hobby of birdwatching. And the reason they were travelling on false passports was because the international sport of birdwatching is extremely competitive. So they didn't want their rivals to know that they were onto some rare birds.
Well, you would have to be out of your fucking tree in some Class A gear to believe that one, Grizzly Adams. And oh yes, speaking of old nose candy, I hear that Jimmy Nesbitt's doctor has advised him to stay away from cocaine, so he's bought himself a 15-foot straw.
Turning to John McBlain now, your manifesto created some controversy, especially the bit where you said you not only wanted to legalise cannabis, but actually make it compulsory for all members of the Stormont Assembly. Can you elaborate on this policy?
Well, the Assembly's already been making a hash of things for the past 4 years. Things have gone to pot, and there are already plenty of dopes in the chamber talking shit. So why not shake the joint up with a bit of wacky-backy?
Turning to the SDLP's Alex Atwood. Alex, would you be in favour of smoking dope in the Assembly?
Personally speaking, I have never had my lips around anything illegal.
That's not what I've heard, Alex.
But I suppose being stoned off your tits might make it easier to listen to one of Bob McCartney's speeches. Well, I can tell you that the people of Mid-Ulster, South Antrim, or wherever the fuck it is I'm standing in, don't like dope. And we don't like dope because the Pope likes dope. And if there's one fucking thing we don't like, it's the Pope. The only thing that we get high on is the sweet sound of country and gospel music. I myself have seen the slippery slope that cannabis leads to. One young man started off with an odd puff. Sorry, Julian.
Well, Willie, never mind, Julian, but I've heard the same said about yourself.
An odd puff on that jazz cigarette. And then he started ecstasy, cocaine, heroin. And now I hear he's become addicted to the most depraved habit of them all. He's taken up fucking line dancing in Draper's Town pubs every weekend.
At this stage, we've now been joined by the former Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, Mo Mowlam, who has recently advocated the legalisation of drugs. Tell me, Mo, did you ever indulge in illegal pharmaceuticals when you were at Stormont Castle?
Of course I did, and you don't think I got through that long Good Friday agreement on fucking hot cross buns, do you? And come on, this could be serious. I had to get stoned to go around hugging all those murdering bastards. And I must tell you now that, Gerry, that in order to get you to sign up to the copper fastened partition, I've got my security boys to put a little something special in your pipe.
Well, fuck me. That explains why I had to send Gerry Kelly out to get another packet of hobnobs, and not him of UTV.
And Mr. Twimble, after you eat my special cakes, you couldn't be asked to argue about the cross-border bodies.
That's right, Mo. But until I met Mr. Adams, I used to think a cross-border body was an IRA informer left in a ditch in the south of Newry. Hold on there, Mrs. Mayhem. You said you put drugs in cakes. So what the fuck am I eating now?
Well, I'll get my friend here, Lloyd Grossman, to explain.
Well, what you and your fellow panelists have been devouring, Dr. Page, is a succulent petite four infused with an oil which has a high content of tetrahydrocannabinol, or what Norman Consenti may refer to as a hash cake.
Jesus, Martin, I haven't felt as weird since the pillars kept me awake for four nights running in fucking Castlereagh.
And I'm so stoned as well, Gerry. Thought I can imagine taking your seat in the next election.
Christ, this must be fucking strong shit, man.
Oh, Gerry, man. How about we bury the hatchet and get back into government?
But what about all this business of dissolving the IRA?
Listen, man. I can just see the IRA dissolving right now in front of me. I love the smell of Semtex in the morning. Well, with all that I can say is no, I can hardly fucking speak. With all that I can say is no. No woman, no cry, as my man Bob Marley used to say.
Bob Marley? Isn't that your man that used to run round that fucking roundabout in Belfast?
No, not Bob. He was fucking Mickey.
Honestly, Gerry, I couldn't give a fuck what religion he was. He just went like man, round and round and up and down and swinging it in and out and pulling it left, right and centre.
That's right, Willie. Mickey Marley's roundabout is the only place even you could be guaranteed a fucking seat.
Ah, yes. Good one, Martin. Yes, I like that. Yes, a good one, Martin. Yes, I like it.
I think this is the appropriate moment to leave the debate. Join us next when we discuss the important issue of police reform.
Hold on a minute. This isn't moving the process forward.
Ah, would you just ever fuck up, Gerry? And stop bogarting those fucking hobnobs.
Testing. Yes. What the fuck? Testing. 1, 2, 1, 2. Yes, we're on the air. Well, Gerry, what do you think of that?
Well, I thought that was very, very funny, I have to say. And I know I don't like McBlain, and you don't like him, but after all, he's given us a fucking laugh over the last 21 years.
Well, I agree, exactly. What did you, what does that analogue thing mean again, that analogue sound?
Well, that means it's taken from old recordings. And it's going back 21 years or so, so it's all compiled onto two different CDs.
Yes, well, I have to say, I can't wait to hear another one of his CDs. I think they're very funny. In fact, they're funnier than fucking Willie McCrea singing.
Anything's funnier than that.
Hello and welcome to tonight's programme. We have various topics to cover, and indeed in the studio we have got plenty of studio guests in here tonight. I want to ask our panel first and foremost about Sammy Wilson's amazing photographs that were appearing in a Sunday newspaper, namely the Sunday World. Was it right for them to publish them or not? Gerry Adams, I want to ask you first and foremost.
Well, I think it just shows the hypocrisy of Sammy Wilson and the DUP. He was the one that voted in favour of barring nude bathing on nude beaches in Northern Ireland and Ireland. And for him to run about with his magic wand hanging about is an insult to his party faithful.
Right, Ian Paisley, what's your view on this?
Well, let me say that Gerry Adams has the audacity to say that Sammy Wilson is a hypocrite, when in natural fact, he's the biggest hypocrite here. I mean, he told us 22 months ago that there was a ceasefire. Then the next thing is, he tells the boys to take their suits off and put their working clothes on, i.e. their balaclavas, and go and blow up the Canary Wharf.
Excuse me, Dr. Paisley. I didn't say anything like that at all. I told them to keep their suits on. I was not involved at all in that crisis. I never knew that bomb was taking place.
All right, I think the less said about that, the better. Right, well, Gerry Fitt, I want to ask you, do you think the press was right to publish these photos?
Oh, fuck, your woman's showing it some tits, isn't it? I mean, they were just right for handling. I wish I had been taking the photographs. Mind you, you'd have needed a steady hand, and I don't think I'd have been able to manage it there, to be honest with you. Right, well, do you think it affected the votes, though, for the DUP? Well, who would vote for that bum there? I mean, he's just an arsehole. He shouldn't have been running around with his bollocks hanging out anyway. And I mean, I tell you what, I've seen a bigger welt than a centipede. He hasn't got what would tickle a mouse, for God's sake. But the fact that he was over in France, Lord Fit, on holidays, does that not lighten matters a bit for him? No, it does, Ned. I don't see why he's running around naked. Is he hard up for clothes or what? Because I have a Kay's catalogue, I'll give him it if he wants. It doesn't matter where you're fellinging about. He let the people of Northern Ireland down and his party down. Right, well, that's okay. John Hume, what's your opinion on this whole escapade?
Well, I don't think people should be allowed to do whatever they want, so long as it does not cause offence. If Sammy Wilson wants to run around naked, that's up to Sammy. But in causing offence to people, then I think he needs to keep his clothes on.
All right, well, let me tell you something, Mr. Hume. Everything that comes out of your fucking gob is an offence. And let me furthermore say that you have no right to talk about Sammy Wilson, who's a member of my party.
Right, Ian, now let him speak. John Hume, continue.
Well, Sammy Wilson should go out and buy some decent clothes. Then he would have nobody poking fun at him. Don't forget, all our people have to respect each other's traditions. We all have to live on this island as one.
Oh, for fuck's sake, somebody turn that slurry pit off, for God's sake.
Now, Dr. Paisley, we're talking about Sammy Wilson here.
Fuck Sammy Wilson. I'm fed up talking about him. It's been a pain in my backside and my daughter's backside for too long, and I don't mean that literally, of course. We're just fed up with him.
Right, well, Gerry Fit, it's a matter of keeping your clothes on, isn't it? Here, hold on a minute. I never took my fucking clothes off. No, I mean Sammy Wilson. Oh, yes, so I keep them on, them will all be happy. Let me tell you something. I would never have done that day.
Well, let me tell you something, Gerry. You couldn't afford to go to France in the first place to strip.
Right, say no more. Gerry Adams, do you think Sammy Wilson should remain or will remain in the DUP?
Well, I don't know, and I don't care. But I do know what the new DUP stands for. And that is Democrats undressed publicly.
Ah, Mr. Adams, you're pushing the fucking boat out, son. Any more of that, I'll be sticking my boot in you.
Right, now, on a final note, Dr. Paisley, do you think the press should have published photos of Sharon Rivers also? I thought it was a bit unfair.
Yes, of course, because she must have known the risks involved in flashing her Gerry Fits in public.
Here, fucking hell on, keep me out of this.
If you'd your chance, Gerry, you'd be well into it, so never mind out of it. Now shut your face.
Right, now, Willie McCrea, I'm going to ask you, what do you think about Sammy, and why do you think Sammy took his clothes off?
Well, it's certainly very hot in the south of France, and I'll tell you, if I'd have had that big girl with me, I'd have had her kecks ripped off here in Northern Ireland. I would not wait until we went to France. So Sammy was right. Well, if your man who's anything like her singing, the Reverend Willie McCrea, would just keep them on, do you think the DUP should have reprimanded Sammy Wilson for this? Certainly not. It's not the DUP that's selling Ulster down the river. It's David Trimble and the Ulster Unionist Party.
Willie, fuck's sake. Stick to singing, for fuck's sake.
I think you'd do a better job if you stuck to singing instead of coming off with the same old rhetoric all the time.
Who do you think you're talking to, Mr. Adams? I'm not sitting here with a gun in my hand under the table.
Nor am I. I'm sitting here with my dick in my hand under the table, you should know.
Right, now, I think that's a typical Republican coming off with answers like that. They can't keep their hands on their tools. Right, now, come on, gentlemen, for fuck's sake, settle it down a bit. John Hume, try and sort this out.
Right, what we need here is dialogue from both sections of our communities. Both traditions need to respect each other's opinions and culture, and we must move forward.
Listen to the fucking white Martin Luther King. Shut your fucking face and away with you. Away and get a haircut, you scruffy git. If you can't manage your hair, your throat will do nicely if you want to get both of them cut. Do me all right.
Come on now, gentlemen. This is getting a little bit out of order. Right, now, we're going to move away from the politicians and speak to Barry McGuigan. Barry McGuigan, obviously you've been affected by the press in more ways than one. Do you think this will have a strain on Sammy Wilson?
Well, I was straining to see what it was he had in those photographs. It's bound to have an effect on Sammy because, I mean, I wouldn't like everyone to see my burrows and my tickling stick hanging out.
Fuck's sake, we have a fucking case here, all right. A fucking nutcase, Barry. Let me tell you something. I'd love to see you making a comeback into the ring again. So I can watch you getting your bollocks knocked in day after day, night after night. You're a cert bet and a fixed odd, son. Right, come on now, lay off him. Chris Eubank, you have had bad press as well. The press have invaded your privacy. How do you think Sammy Wilson feels about these photographs and that?
Well, let me say this here. That I feel very sorry for Sammy Wilson because he decided to sue a newspaper because his penis is too small. The fact that if Sammy Wilson had had a big penis, he wouldn't have sued the newspapers because I think he's just embarrassed and that's why he's decided to sue the newspaper.
So, I mean, I ask you, Chris, if you were in the south of France on holiday with a big school teacher such as Sharon Rivers, would you have went bollock naked?
Well, let me say this here. I don't think my wife Sandra would have allowed me to do this because she would have objected very strongly.
Well, I think we've said enough on this issue, but just food for thought. Sammy Wilson brings a whole new meaning to the school dinner spanking sessions, as I'm sure you've all read about. He's the one that objected to the light-hearted fun and entertainment being dished out, and indeed got the boot into Sandy Blair and Junior Walker over this incident. But I think both these gentlemen have had the last laugh, do you?
Taxi! Taxi, excuse me, sir. Is this taxi free or what?
It is, my good man. I wouldn't be on the rank if I wasn't free.
All right, don't be getting lippy, for goodness sake. Just give us a wee scoot in around the town. I want to see what changes there's been down here in the south. I'm sure there's been a brave few from the last time I was down here to rescue my friend, Peter the Punt Robinson. Oh, here, by the way, Mervyn, put those bags in the back. Not the wife, the bags. Fucking plank. Yes, let's go and have a wee scoot around the town.
Right. On the right-hand side here, we have the four courts.
The four courts,
where the famous
right.
Michael Collins fought the battle.
Who's that Collins one, Mervyn? Oh, I think he's the boxer. Steve Collins? No, you fucking idiot. What's his name? Michael, is it?
That's the very man, Michael
yes,
Collins.
Yes, Michael Collins, yes. Well, I don't know about him being that famous up in the north. He certainly is up in the south. But talking about the four courts, with the amount of hoods as politicians that you have down there, you need more than four courts. You need 40 courts for Charlie Hockey alone, the gun runner himself.
There's plenty of those down here.
Oh, yes, there
Brown is. Envelope jobs for all the politicians down here.
Well, when we get brown envelopes up in the north and there's cables hanging from them, I normally get the wife to open the mail. I say, right, Eileen, you open that up there. No, we don't do that. No, I don't get stuff like that. Just make sure you take it easy, Fred. I'm very susceptible to being sick. Especially when I see Mo Mowlam or Tony Blair on the screens. So where are we now? Where are you?
We're coming down along the quays now.
Right.
Just on your right-hand side over there.
It's very nice.
You have City Hall on one side, and behind that again you have Dublin Castle. I'm sure you've heard of Dublin Castle.
Yes, many a time I have spat at it. Yes, I've been at Dublin Castle. Yes. But it's equivalent to our Stormont. Only Stormont is more glorious, I have to say. And what about O'Connell Street, Fred?
Well, we'll be just coming down to that now. We'll take the right turn here. We'll be just at O'Connell Street.
Yes, is this where the ladies of the night hang out?
Oh, that's for sure.
I bet you there's more than that hanging out at about 12 o'clock at night.
Oh, without a doubt, my man.
Yes, I think I'll be back down here myself to see if I can get latch on to one. Island's in Belfast, so you might as well make hay while the sun shines.
Now, on the right-hand side here on O'Connell Street, we have the GPO, which is the General Post Office.
Yes, that's where Gerry Adams goes and gets his Gerry cash, isn't that right?
That's correct.
Yes, and of course, Bertie Ahern, they're all at their work. And Charlie Hockney. Yes. And what about the nightlife? What's it like?
Oh, very, very good here. Exceptionally good nightlife. In around the Temple Bar area and that.
Oh, well, you know yourself that I wouldn't drink at any bars, Freddy. I'm a teetotaler, totally against all that devil's buttermilk. Now, Mervyn, he would have a drink.
Mervyn's a good drinker, he is.
Well, there's nothing wrong with having the odd old pint of Guinness, Mr. Paisley. You know,
well, certainly not in front of me, of course. You're going to slap the fucking mouth. I'll not be tolerating any of that. You hope you don't touch that devil's buttermilk yourself, friend.
No.
Are you saved?
No, teetotaler.
Pat Jennings couldn't save you, son, isn't that right?
That's correct.
Yes, well, Packy Bonner, as they would say. But what about all this traffic that's down here in the south?
It's unbelievable. It's
terrible, the amount
every
of cars.
Day, 24 hours a day, non-stop, bumper to bumper.
And then you had these traffic wardens.
Oh, them sure the bastards.
Yes, they're clapping everybody.
That's for sure.
And I tell you what, all I have to say is to all of those traffic wardens, you're a sharp bastards. That's all I have to say to them.
I don't often agree with you, but I agree with you on that.
Well, I don't see why you would disagree with me, because I obviously am a minister and I'm an honest man. I've been telling the truth for 40 years. Watch that fucking car, for God's sake, friend. There you rode off. Fuck's sake. How long have you been driving?
Oh, 25 years.
Non-stop the look of things and you're running that fucking car there. But anyhow, it's not a very nice day, is it? The old grey skies of the Republic.
That's because you come down here. It's normally sunshine because...
Oh, well, I don't think so. I think it's Bertie Ahern and all the rest. I'm talking all the shite of the day. That's why you've got the grey mists of the Republic. And of course, I don't mind actually exchanging the blue skies of Ulster for the grey mists of the Republic. So what do you think yourself, getting political here? Do you think we're going to have this United Ireland?
Oh, I'd say eventually down the road it will come.
Over my dead fucking body, Freddy.
Sure, we all know that.
Certainly not by happening my day, I'll tell you that.
That's why we'd have to get rid of you first.
You'll get a boot in the bollocks. You'll have a long wait for another 30 or 40 years in this old dog yet. Yes. Should knock that man down. One less for mass.
Well, we're coming up now to Leinster House, where the Irish government sit.
Aye, that's all they do. They sit and they do fuck all. Scratching their arses. Another Podgester Rossa, Gerry Adams lookalike. The dirty birdie. But that's a terrible price to be charging per mile.
We'll be charging you double when you get out.
I don't think so, son. There'll be a parcel in the back of your fucking boot.
You'll be getting the sterling off you.
Well, let me tell you something. I would never burn holes in my pockets, put punts inside them. There's always the good, loyal Ulster, Her Majesty, and whatever else on the back of my notes.
There's nothing wrong with you taking the punts out of your churches up around Monaghan and that.
Me tell you this. Here, some bastard is having a concerted effort to burn my churches out. Somebody is setting a light to my Free Presbyterian Church. And it's a disgrace. It's sacrilegious. It's blasphemous. Burning my churches. I hope you don't agree with that.
I don't agree with it, but what you're saying is wrong. You take the Irish pound from this side of the border and then you're complaining you wouldn't put it in your pocket.
Well,
you're putting it in the bank, aren't you?
No, I'm not worried about the Irish pound. I'm talking about my church. My church is more important than pounds, pumps or anything else you want to talk about. I would like to know who's burning out my churches, trying to rid the Ulster Protestants out of the south.
There's very few of them left here now.
Well, I know that.
We got rid of most of them anyway.
I tell you what, there's very few of them left in the north as well because of Adams and fucking Artie Funkel McGuinness trying to push us out. It's not going to work.
Why didn't you take a stand on the peace process?
As far as I'm concerned, I never got involved in the talks because they're a sellout to Ulster. You just don't understand that. You just don't care, that's what it is. What the arse on that. Lovely arse. Beautiful set of breasts.
Oh, Dr. Paisley, I just want to ask you one thing. Prices of houses...
Just call me Ian, friend.
Ian?
Yes.
Okay, my man. House prices in the north compared to the south, what do you think of those?
Well, I think the houses in the north are very good value. Better than the slums I've seen up here in the south. Some of the houses up in the north are around about £100,000. That's for the average house. I don't know what you're paying for your slums down here, but I'm sure it's nowhere near £100,000. What sort of money are you paying? Look at that fucking motorbike. Reckless bastard. Fred, just pulling at this boogie, sir. I want to go in and do a bet, so I do.
Have you got a few winners today?
Oh, well, I've got a couple of tips. I'll tell you what, I'm going to put a tenner on whatever Jim McDade's on, I'll tell you that.
Well, the only thing now about this little bookie here is he's a staunch Catholic. I didn't think you'd like to win there.
Well, nothing would give me more greater pleasure than to take the money of a good finger. I'll tell you better than that. But I'm in this bookmaker's. I really am going to bet on there's not going to be United Ireland.
You reckon?
Yes. Just pull in here, Fred. This'll do all right. You want a horse done or what?
Ah, here. Put a fiver on him.
You can stop now, or do you want me to fucking jump out while we're still going, Fred?
I'm prepared to shoot in the back if you want.
Right. Swift kick in the balls you'll get. But anyway, what do you owe you anyway, son?
£8.
What about pumps?
I'll give us sterling.
There. Take it out of that. In fact, keep the change. All the best. Chucky our lad.
All the best, my man. Good luck.
Right, come on, Murphy. Get those fucking bags out. Lizzy bastard.
Wait, I'm doing it now, Doctor. Get, come on.
That's right. All the best, Fred.
Good luck to you, my man.
All right, I just have one more phone call to make here. Yes, that number Bertie gave me.
Hello, you've reached the offices of the Progressive Democrats. Sorry we can't take your call right now. If you'd like to leave a message, we'll call you as soon as possible. Thank you, goodbye.
Hello, this is a message for Mary Harney. Ian Paisley here. I was just wondering if by any chance you and my son Ian Jr. fancied meeting up for a bit of a chat to see how yous might get on. He's knocking on a bit, as you know, and I would like to see him settle down with somebody who was familiar with the rough and tumble of political life. So I thought you might be interested. Obviously, the fact that you're a Fenian is a major problem, but I can see a way around that. You could undergo a conversion course to Free Presbyterianism and come here and live in the North. Things have settled down a lot, you know that. And you'd have absolutely no trouble buying your own house up here. And another good thing, you could join a party that already had some seats. It would be a good change for you. Anyway, let me know what you think and get back to me as soon as you possibly can. Thanks.
Right, Ian Paisley, this new party was voted in on the May the 30th of this year. Of course, that being the Women's Coalition Party. What good do you think they'll do in Northern Ireland?
Well, they're a good advert for prostitution, for politics, because of the way they got some of their votes. I mean, they were canvassing for more than votes, if you ask me. And as far as I'm concerned, they're a party full of slappers. Dole scroungers, and they'll do nothing for the people in Northern Ireland.
Well, that seems a bit coarse or a bit harsh, but Gerry Fitt, do you agree with what Ian Paisley has said?
Well, some of it I agree with. I mean, I had one of them Women's Coalition members coming on to me to get a vote, and I told her politely to fuck off. Now, if she didn't have a hump in her back, that would have been a different matter. I would have considered giving her one. A vote, that is.
Right, well, Gerry Adams, are they a no-hope party or what?
Did you say a no-dope party? Sorry, hope party. Well, they do have a mandate to represent people in Northern Ireland. So I don't see any reason why they don't hang in there and try and expand their party when the voting comes around next time.
Right, well, Gerry Fitt, do you think the Women's Coalition Party can go forward and meet the needs of the people of this country?
Well, they do meet the needs of the people of this country. I mean, they cook, wash dishes, shovel shit. What more can you ask for?
Well, I was thinking maybe of getting the yard brushed and a car maybe washed. But anyway, John Hume, do you agree that they need to do more?
Well, I think the Women's Coalition Party need to be respected for what they have done. It's not much, but it's a start. And we need to give them the chance to develop into a fully fledged party.
Well, the ones that were canvassing outside my door were fully developed, all right. You want to see the tits on them.
Right, now, come on, Dr. Paisley, there's no need for that. Dick Spring, do you think the Women's Coalition Party have anything to offer?
Big set of tits, and that's about your fucking lit. Right now, Gerry, come on, let Dick talk. Oh, fuck. Talking Dick. Go ahead, Dickie.
Well, I think the people in Ireland... Northern Ireland, you bollocks! Sorry, I mean in Northern Ireland, can benefit immensely from a new party that has got new ideas. And I hope that they share their ideas with the people in the south of Ireland.
Oh, listen to the spider, to the fly, trying to lure the women's coalition party into this dirty Republican web. I know what you're at, trying to drain their brains. Not that it would take long to do that, mind you, but we know what side of the fence you're on, Dickie.
Right now, Gerry Fitt, do you think the women's coalition party have anything to offer the Dublin government?
No.
Right, well, let's move on. That answers that. The Reverend William McCrea, what have you got to say in the Women's Coalition Party?
Well, all I can say is that the Women's Coalition Party meet with the Dublin government. Then I put them in the same league as Sinn Féin. They're no good to Ulster. They're trying to sail us down the river.
Fuck's sake, Willie, now stick a cork in it.
Right, Gerry Adams, do you agree with that?
No, I certainly do not agree. I don't like the same old rhetoric. I don't like the same old shite that he comes out with. I don't like his singing, and I don't like his bigotry. And,
listen to the man of the fucking world, Mr. Adams, man of the world, Jesus Christ, grow your beard a bit longer, and we'll all put you up for the night. Go ahead, Gerry.
Right, now, come on now. Now, if there's any members of the Women's Coalition Party listening to this programme that say no one fucking likes us or supports us, in fact, everyone hates us, Gerry Fitt.
Aye, they'd be fucking right too. They're better going back to their knitting jumpers for their grandsons and granddaughters instead of trying to rally against the big boys. I mean, they're in a league of their own. They're not with it at all.
Right, well, Dr. Paisley, I think we've all been guilty of sexist remarks about the Women's Coalition Party.
Well, politics is a tough job. And it's no good running around with your finger up your arse and your mind in neutral in this game. Some of these little parties are about as much use as a nice train of motorbike. And the sooner they leave it to the more experienced parties, like the Democratic Unionists, the better.
Gerry Adams?
Well, Sammy Wilson's a great advert for politics and the DUP. John Lennon would have been proud of him, flower power and all that shit. I mean, just think for a moment about the panel on the Democratic Unionist Party. We have Ian Paisley, who won't budge an inch for the sake of our up-and-coming generation. We get the same old spiel and the same old rhetoric. And then we have Peter the Punt Robinson, who's always close by when Ian Paisley needs to go for a shite. Another bigot that has adapted to his leader's thinking. And then we have the Reverend William McCrea, who does more singing than talking, and quite poorly at that. And then we have Sammy the Chippendale Wilson, who likes to bear all for his party. And then we have Nigel Dodds, Ken Dodds' son, the Diddy Man, who never changes his spiel or rhetoric. So I think the Women's Coalition Party have absolutely nothing to fear from the same old repertoire from the boring DUP.
Right, well, Ian Paisley, how do you respond to that?
Normally with a size 12 boot, but fight fire with fire. Mr. Adams has done his utmost to upset members of my party. So let's have a laugh at the Sinn Féin lineup. Firstly, we have Grizzly Adams, who's been in jail more times than the average prison warder, uses violence to get his own way, and uses threats to try and get more demands of the British government. He got a broadcasting ban put upon him because the ozone layer was being bombarded with pollutants. And then we move swiftly to Martin McGuinness, who is the commandant in Londonderry. His experience, well, about 8 years in jail, and he's proud of it. And that's where he gets his education from as well. And it's probably the first time he's ever seen a television. We don't need to go into jail to get these luxuries, as you know. But then we have Alex Take Your Maskey Off. He's the bulldog of Sinn Féin, again another porridge lover. Who is very fond of hitting members of the RUC. But oddly enough, he's the one that ends up with the compensation claim. And then we go into Martin O'Mullier. That man needs a good fucking feed. I mean, he's that thin you can smell the shite through him. If he ate beans, he'd come out in lumps. I don't know whether he's been in prison or not, but I'm sure it's only a matter of time. So the Coalition Party, the Women's Coalition Party, have nothing to fear of Sinn Féin, because their track records are as bent as O.J. Simpson.
Right, well, every bit of wonder this country's in a right fucking mess as it is.
Where am I going to sit?
Where am I going to fucking sit? Never mind you. Here, hold on a minute. There's 12 seats. There's enough room here for everybody.
I think you're sitting here, Mr. Paisley.
You're not fucking... Get out of my seat. You're not getting there.
Well, where am I going to sit?
You're not meant to be at the table, son. You're meant to be fucking underneath it.
Right now. Come on now. There's no need for that there.
There's no need for that either. I mean, that's bloody terrible talking to me like that.
Just park your horse anyway, John, for fuck's sake. Just sit anywhere you want. The fuck's that?
You just could. Do you want me to answer that door?
Yes, I think you may as well.
Here, hold on. I own the fucking house. It's me that pays the mortgage. Right, Gerry, you can go and answer it.
All right, no problem at all. Wonder who it is, for fuck's sake.
It's probably the bailiffs, for fuck's sake, of the bomb squad to save anything in this house.
There's no need for that, darn it.
Right, who's there?
It's Chris.
Chris fucking who? Chris who?
It's Chris Eubank.
Chris Eubank? Come on in that day. What about you, Chris, boy? How you doing, son, all right?
I'm not too bad, actually, but let me say this here. I don't think it was very nice the way you were talking to me.
All right, I'll keep your fucking hair on. I was only joking you, for God's sake. I'm only doing a wee bit of raking about, like. Oh, by the way, Chris, we're going to have a white Christmas. I hope that didn't sound a wee bit, unseasonal, like me saying that. Are you being black and all? It's going to be a white Christmas. I didn't mean that.
I know exactly what you're talking about, Mr. Fitton. I don't think that was very nice.
Come on, then, stop your fucking yapping. Look here, it's Chris.
Oh, fuck's sake. Who let you out of the trees?
Excuse me, Dr. Paisley. I don't think that was very nice.
Well, just sit in your hole there. Stop your fucking yapping. Right, Chris, come on now, sit down there. There's no need for that there. By the way, when I said about the white Christmas, I didn't mean that to sound like a racist remark.
Let me say this here, Mr. Fitton. I don't think it was very nice what you said.
Shut up and get the fucking drink in these. Stop your yapping. What do you want, banana juice or what?
Oh, come on now, Gerry. There's no need for that there. Don't be fucking taking a piss out of him.
Take a piss out of him? I'll take the fucking hand out of him. Right now, come on, where are we going to be sitting here? Come on, let's get down to this. Table here.
I'll tell you what, it looks very nice, whatever it is.
I hope that's not trying to be funny, is it?
Let me say, it smells very beautiful.
I bet it doesn't smell as good as that there.
Fuck you, there's no need for that. Come on now, gentlemen.
Ian Paisley, leave
me alone. Leave me alone, farting at the table like that. It's a fucking disgrace.
Oh, come on now, come on.
Nothing to say, your food is smelling very beautiful indeed.
Well, I hope you're not trying to insult Teresa's cooking, because you do smell the fart now, because I can smell it.
Right, come on, give it all over now.
Yeah, come on now, listen, there's enough of the lot of us here. Oh, yes, right, Robert, what do you want?
I want some potato sundae.
Right, get that on the air plate.
Well, I'll tell you what, the grub does smell very nice, it's really nice indeed.
Of course, now, you're all familiar with Robert, who's a guest with us tonight. And, Robert, what exactly do you want in that plate? Do you want your potatoes?
Yes, can I have some more, please?
Hey, Arne, is that enough fare? Look, is that
enough? No, I need some more.
Looks like you've got my mouth only again, Paisley.
Hey, you shut your fucking faces.
Right, come on, gentlemen, there's no need for that. Dr. Paisley, leave him alone.
I was only cracking him. What are you cracking a joke on? I'm going to crack the fucking bake for it. There's no need for that there. Good sick. Right, Robert, what do you want there? You want more spud?
Yes. Hold on. Ah, my kids are roasting dry on. Give me some water. My spuds are burning up. Jesus Christ. I burnt my tongue.
That'll fucking hurt you anyway. Yes, that's what I like to say. That was a laugh.
I don't think it was very funny at all.
It hurt me so bad.
Sake, that makes us fuck. It's like cutting into my boots, for fuck's sake.
Well, I think it is a wee bit overdone, like.
You're right, it is.
Robert, you're meant to put the potatoes in your mouth, son, not around your cheeks.
Is he putting potatoes up his arse?
No, he just forgets where his mouth is. Charles, are you okay there for spuds and peas?
Yes, actually, I'd like to. I thought we were getting chicken for dinner instead of this.
What are you trying to say? Well,
let me say this here to you, Charlie. If you want chicken, you better go out into the garden and catch the bastard.
No, tell you the truth, we're getting rabid because, as you know, Gerry Adams has said in his book, as you all know, that he shot a rabbit. And is that right, Gerry? I didn't know you had to have a balaclava on to shoot a rabbit.
Are you trying to be funny?
Oh, I'm just passing conversation. Didn't say that in your book, and I don't think you would tell lies.
It's the biggest lot of fucking shit you ever did here. Get the grub in the back of your neck. Robert, I see you're into these Christmas crackers.
Yes, I love them. Gerry, will you pull another one with me?
One of you promised to come up as there. All right, well, come on then, let's go. After three, one,
two, three, go! Oh, fucking magic, sir. I love them. I love them crackers. I could put them all night. Now, here's the joke. What do you call a deer with no eyes?
Fucking no idea, for fuck's sake. Everybody knows that's a lot of shite.
You didn't need a spoiler for me.
Come on, Robert. Fucking wait. I'm here. Pull another one there. Look, since you didn't get there. Where's that cracker? Is that another one there? Give us it. Ready to pull, Robert?
Yes, I am.
Hold on, I get my zip down. That fucking scared you. Right, here we go. One, two, three.
Here we go. No, that's brilliant, sir.
Oh, that was a good one there. That's spectacular.
Right, here's what it says. Did you hear about the man who thought he was a deli, baby? The doctor chewed the head off him. Oh, fuck.
Oh, that's a lot of shit. That's a lot of fuck that was.
Well, I thought that was quite funny, actually. That was a nice one.
That's another slap of that. Do you want any more beer? Yes, sir. Fucking right, I want another beer.
Mr. Percy, he's picking his nose again.
Now, fuck up, you, for God's sake. Let it do fuck all in peace here.
Gerry, come on, get your finger out of the fucking snout. When you get to the bridge, give us a wave.
Right, now, come on, gentlemen. Settle it all down, for God's sake.
There's another joke, Lander. I saw it there. It says, how do you kill 100 flies at once? How do you be offering up a face with a shovel?
Well, I don't think that was funny. That was not funny.
No, it wasn't it. Robert, come here.
Well, I saw it once.
Fucking slap a bit. Hey, come on, now.
Jesus Christ, settle it down. What'd you hit him for?
Well, I didn't think I was one bit funny. There's no need for that there at all. It was a disgrace.
Oh, yes. Oh, very nice indeed. Right, Mr. McGuigan, what are you doing?
Well, here, let me tell you something. I need to go to the toilet, so I do. I'm busting for a slice. Gerry, where's your toilet?
It's out in the yard, first and the right.
Fuck, I thought you'd been a Catholic, I would have been on the left.
Well, it's on the right, okay.
Right, well, here, I'm away to bog. I'll see you in a minute, all right?
Quick, leave that door in the hinges, you bastard, you.
So he's away to bug. Here, Gerry.
What do you want now, for fuck's sake, Mr. Finn?
Yeah, I'll tell you the truth. I'm busting for a slice as well, mate, and I fucking can't hold on, honest to fuck.
Look, Gerry, let me tell you something. Barry McGuigan is away to the toilet. There's no way you can go to the toilet.
Mr. Adams, I swear to fuck, I'm begging you, I'm busting for a slice.
Well, I'll tell you what, Gerry, why don't you pitch in his soup?
Hey,
Barry McGuigan's pitch in his soup. You don't know the fucking difference.
Fuck, I don't know whether I should do that there or not, nay. Mr. Adams, do you think it'd be all right for me to have a slice in Barry McGuigan's soup, or what the fuck am I going to do? I mean, I'm going to bust it. I'm going to end up pissing your carpet.
Well, let me tell you now, Gerry. If he catches you on and knocks your bollocks in, I'm taking nothing to do with it, all right?
Well, how long they get on top of this table here? Oh, fuck. Now, keep dick for him, Mr. Paisley, all right?
Yes, I'm watching the door.
Let me get this zipped in here. Oh, Jesus Christ. Oh, now, keep dick for him now. You watching for him?
Yes, we're watching the fucking door. Stop panicking. Ugh.
Oh, dear fuck. Oh, fuck, that's a sour leaf that there. Oh, do you think he'll notice?
You think he'll notice us? Fill to the fucking brim. Of course I'll notice, you dirty fucker, you.
Right, come on now. Never let on. Just sit down, never fucking mind already. Not no difference, okay? You're not no difference. Just everybody, now, nobody in the house say fuck all about what happened, all right?
Well, thank God for that there. That was, I needed that there. I was busting for that. God, I'm glad I got rid of that there, all right? Here, did somebody fill my soup up? It looks as though it's been filled up again. Did I get some hot stuff?
Oh, you did, eh?
Have a wee sample of this. Tell you what, your second bowl never tastes as good as your first, but I'm going to finish it anyway, I'll tell you that now.
Mr. Adams, Could I use your lavatory, please? I'm busting for a good shite.
Well, you know where it is. Out in the yard and first on the right. All right?
Yes, thank you very much. I'll see you in a sec.
Look, and everybody's room the toilet. What do you bring that snobby bastard over here for, anyway?
Well, he's got plenty of money, and he's a good laugh, which is more than I can say for you, Gerry.
Well, it might not be a good laugh, but I'm proud to be a Catholic anyway and kick with a fucking left foot.
Let me tell you, Mr. Fit, any more of that, I'll be kicking you with both feet, you slobber, you.
Mr. Adams.
What the fuck does he want now?
Mr. Adams.
Hold on a second, I'll go and see what the fuck he wants. Charlie, what is it you want?
Mr. Paisley, I'm sorry to bother you, but I'm in a very embarrassing situation. You see, there's no toilet tissue in the toilet, and my cheeks are plastered in shite.
Well, fuck, I don't know what you're going to do, son. If there's no toilet tissue, I'm afraid you're going to have to use that towel there to wipe your arse with.
Are you absolutely sure that I should wipe my ass in the towel?
Of course, fucking wipe. It's not my fucking house. It's only a mick anyway. Go ahead, wipe your arse on that.
Okay, Miss Missy, thank you.
It's all right. It was only Charlie was looking to get some soap for to wash his hands.
All right, I see. He wanted soap? Fuck, I didn't know the royals waste. Here,
I tell you what, I feel a bit ill, so do you? I think I need to get to the bathroom.
Barry, what the fuck, Tommy?
I don't know, I must want something to eat, or I feel as though I'm going to be sick.
Don't be sick all over his carpet, or sorry, shoot aside, don't be sick all over his bare floor. There is not even a carpet on it.
Don't be trying to be funny, of course there's a fucking carpet on it.
Barry, let me say this here. The toilets are out there if you want to.
But Charlie's out to the toilets.
Excuse me, Mr. McGuigan, I'm back. You can go to the toilet now.
Thank fuck for it. I'll see you in a minute, so well.
For fuck's sake, he's a pain in the arse. Never done running the bloody bugs.
I think that slice I had in the soup must be taking effect on him, you know.
Well, if you were drinking pie, son, you'd be sick as well, wouldn't you?
Mr. Fitty, I think it was very dirty of you to do that into Mr. McGuigan's soup.
Oh, is that right?
Well, Charlie, let us have a word in your ear. Let me whisper in your lung.
Yes, what is it?
What did you do with that towel you wiped your arse on?
Well, actually, I just left it hanging up over the rail.
God save us all. Fucking McGuigan's in there, you plank. Could you not have threw it outside or something?
Right, now, what about us all singing a little Christmas carol or something, a wee bit of a warm-up before the final thing towards the end of the programme?
Yes, let's all join in together and sing Jingle Bells after three. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Whoa, jingle bollocks, jingle bollocks, jingle all.
Well, I don't think that's really that good. I think we need a bit of fucking music too. It's a lot of shanks on this.
Oh, here, tell you what. That was great, that singing there. Well, it sounded like singing to me. It wasn't bad.
Barry, I hate to ask you, but what's that in your face?
I don't know. I think it's it may be Teresa's face pack. I come off that towel. What do you? Here, what the fuck? It smells terrible.
I think you've got shade in your face, Barry.
Oh, for fuck's sake! Somebody's put shade all over the towel. That's disgusting. So does that go and get my gob washed?
Oh, fuck's sake! That wasn't nice.
I don't think I was. Let me tell you something. That's the only fucking towel I have in the house. I have to wash that. Who done that?
Well, it wasn't me anyway.
It certainly wasn't me either.
I'm afraid to say it wasn't me either.
Well, somebody's wiped their fucking arse on it, and it's not very funny at all.
What's wrong with you?
Actually, I feel a little bit sick because of the antics of Mr. Finn jumping onto the table to pace in Mr. McGuigan's suit.
Oh, is that what fucking happened, you pace?
No, it didn't. That. He's talking to his fucking hat. I'd never touch it.
You fucking bastard, you done it!
Right, come on, fuck's sake. Settle it down here.
He plays a nice shape and Barry, I'm not even joking.
Right now, come on, I'm gonna pull a fucking armalite out now. Come on over.
Hey, Mr. Cacadilla, will you pull this with me?
I don't think you should say that to your priest, because you might regret it.
Well, if you pull it with me, I'll do something for you.
Well, that sounds like an offer I cannot refuse, because Now, tell you what, Robert, I have something here that would entice you to do what I so desire.
What is it?
I have a dairy lee cheese triangle in my pocket. And I'm...
All right, now, come on, fucking cattle, wake up now. You're a dirty pedophile, you bastard, you. You dirty...
Now, hold on a second. I was only going to suggest to make him a cheese sandwich.
I know what sort of fucking sandwich you're after, you wee bastard, you. Right, come on now, let's settle this out there. Right, come on, I'll pull this cracker with you.
Oh, here we go, here we go.
Oh, yes, that's great, that's superb. I'm not reading a fucking joke and I couldn't be arsed with it.
Here, tell you what, but I still feel a bit terrible sick with that there old Chinese or whatever the fuck I had.
Oh, that was Robert you had. It's a Christmas dinner, not a fucking Chinese dinner, you dickhead.
Well, whatever it was, and the soup and oil and the patient.
All right, Barry, stop your crying for fuck's sake. You think you've just been defeated in one of your fights, because that's all you ever get. Whinging, whinging, whinging. Good sake.
Well, we're going to go away now and do the rest of our business later on and finish off the festivities in style, but we will go out with a Christmas carol. I hope you enjoy this. Right, come on now, get all gathered round.
Where my fucking stand?
Gather round.
Oh, yes, now, come on, let's sing this properly. Robert, get away now.
Sorry.
Right, come on now. After five or six.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. With every Christmas card I write.
Let me fucking think.
Get up. Where the tree tops glisten and children listen with sleigh bells hanging from their arse.
That wasn't very neat. Let me sing now.
I'm dreaming of a shade Christmas just like the one I used to know.
So you scare the cats and dogs, boy.
May your days be happy and bright.
Singing the wrong word, Jeff Alex.
And may all of your Christmases be shade.
Well, there you have it. John Cole signing off here. Merry Christmas.
At this time, we should reflect on what makes good Ulster Protestant Unionists. A Roman Catholic once asked me, Dr. Paisley, what makes you a Unionist? And I replied, my father was a Protestant Unionist, and his father before him was a Protestant Unionist. And what, says he, would you be if your father had been an arsehole, and your father before him had been an arsehole? A Fenian, I said. I want to tell you this here, that I will resist with all my might any attempt to betray our Protestant heritage. Don't let John Hume soft soap you. Not the Fenians would be that familiar with soap. No, John Hume is Ulster's greatest enemy. They say he is a self-made man, and he worships his creator. Now, wee Willie McCrea once asked me, what's the difference between a misfortune and a calamity? I told him, Willie, it would be a misfortune if John Hume fell into the foil, and it would be a calamity if somebody pulled the bastard back out again. Mr. Hume says we'd all be better off in his agreed Ireland. Sure, doesn't Ulster already lead the world in several areas? I mean, in Ballymena, we were the first to have safe sex. Good, strong sex that keeps the rats out of the spuds. And aren't we famous for our fashion? Some of our biggest fish, you'll see, have been caught in the River Pan. So to whom, or Hume, it may concern, yous Fenians think you're so clever, the union you hope to sever, but you'll never beat Protestant endeavour, Surrender to Dublin. Feck off. Never.
Right, well, Dr. Paisley, I appreciate now that you've got your say and you're finished.
No, I'm not finished at all, because later on in the programme I will be wanting to say more on this.
Well, the talks themselves, now, I must say things are pretty slow. When we first started going up to Stormont, we enjoyed the crack. The first day I arrived there, I asked the security guard, who was a statue outside, who was it off? And he said it was off Carson. And Martin asked why Carson, and I said, well, it must have been the way he told him. I think that when we take part, we'll put up a statue of Jimmy Cricket, just beside Carson. Now, when we got inside the talks, Mo Mowlam tried to offer us a cup of tea and an Ulster fry. No way, I said. Sinn Féin will only accept an occupied six-county fry with cross-border real executive powers. Then after the morning session, she offered us biscuits, Jaffa cakes, would you believe? And there's no way that Sinn Féin or any member of my party will take an orange biscuit. And then, now every day we're sitting opposite the official Unionist party. And they're sitting there like your wife at the breakfast table when you wake up with a hangover, all picture, no sound. And I tried to engage the other day with Ken McGuinness, and he said to me, he doesn't talk with murdering fuckers. I said, nerdy eye, I usually fax him my instructions. But he was very upset with that, and he had a word in my ear, and I can't really repeat what he said.
Ian Paisley, we want to get away from politics for one moment because we are, I'm sure everyone's fed up listening to the old political, but what about films and your interests and whatever else? Did you, I mean, for instance, did you go and see the Titanic?
Yes, I went and seen that film Titanic with Eileen the other night. A lot of fucking Fenian propaganda, if you ask me. And of course, the Titanic was built at Harlem Wolf. And this film is a terrible slur on the good Protestant workmanship.
No wonder it went down. I bet it would have survived if at least 50% of the workforce had been Catholic.
The fuck would you know about it? I bet you would have been the first one on the lifeboats. Fuck the women and children first. That would have been your assessment.
It might have been women and children first, but it was Irish Catholics last. I would have demanded parity of esteem on the lifeboats with guaranteed representation for all concerned groups. I can tell you now that if the Titanic were sailing today, Sinn Féin would have the following demands. The Titanic would be rerouted past all icebergs and sail directly into Irish America, where it would pick up a few tons of Sinn Féin election material. Secondly, I would be the ship's captain. I mean, some people say that if my hair was grey, I would look like Captain Birdseye.
So thought there was something fishy about you, son.
And I could guarantee all party representation at the captain's table. And if there was any pressure at the bar, I could pull a few pints. And three, if we were sinking, the band would not play Near My God to Thee. It would play A Nation Once Again with Willie McCrea on the accordion. Four, places on the lifeboats would be allocated in the first manner, in alphabetical order.
Aye, right, and what's the difference between the Titanic and your good friend Bill Clinton, Gerry?
I've no idea.
Only 1,500 went down on the Titanic.
Right now, Dr. Paisley, there's no need for that, for goodness sake.
We want to move this process forward. And the people in this island, they desire to have peace. And I want to make a...
Now, Martin, you said you were going to come in today and give us your fucking poem. Are you going to give us it or are you not?
Right, well, no problem, John. This is a poem that I love. It's called My Love is Like an Armalite. And this is the way it goes. My love is like an Armalite, the rifle of great renown. I love to gently grease her up and then slowly strip her down. As I put my bullet in her breech, as moist as the river foil, she softly moans her day will come as I feel her strong recoil. She then ejects the cartridge case and murmurs her sweet thanks. As I say, I hope you're bulletproof, because I never fire blanks.
Well, that was absolutely marvellous. Very, very nice indeed, Martin. I didn't think you were capable of nearly bringing a tear to my eye, but anyway, every priest says that to the altar boys.
Well,
And turning to you, Gerry Adams, Mr. Adams, it has been suggested that some people, in fact, the Republican prisoners, are having a great time in the Maze prison. I mean, wild parties, sex, drugs, etc. In fact, it is said that there are so much drugs in the Maze prison that they're going to change the name from the H blocks to the E blocks. Is that right?
Well, I can tell you now, John, that's all a pack of lies spread by British propaganda machine. Sorry. Hello? Hello, reverse the charges from Her Majesty's prison. Oh, here, hold on a minute. Do you think I made the money? I haven't even got my royalties from off my book yet. Okay, I'll accept the call. 48p a minute? That's extortionate. And I should know all about extortion. All right, Patrick. Yes, you've got 1-1 with Gerry Adams, NP. How's the prisoners of war? Sorry, could you turn that fucking rave music down in the background? I can't hear you. What is it you want? 2 shovels, stepladder, rope, wire cutters, a fucking motorbike. Jesus, Patrick. Don't tell me you've been watching A Great Escape again. Okay, I'll give it a go. Though I wouldn't like to be the one who's going to visit you with a motorbike up his arse. What was that? You were saying the screws thought they caught an escaper this morning. Someone going out on an ill-fitting wig with a funny pair of tits. Well, that was only Mo Mowlam. Don't worry about that.
I don't think that was very funny, Mr. Adams. This wig cost me an absolute fortune. I got it from the same place as Elton John.
Well, it looks like it was made from the same breed of gerbil. Anyway, Patrick, you were saying the screws were 2 out on the head count this evening. That's great. 2 boys should be over the border by now. What do you mean there were 2 extra? 2 released prisoners broke back in because they missed a crack? Fuck me, Patrick. I think I'll join you. Sorry, Patrick, you're fading. You're fading. That's British fucking telecom for you.
Right, well, I don't believe that for one moment. Now, Dr. Paisley, a very, very strange thing in the news of late was about cloning. Now, it must be a very worrying aspect to think. I mean, there could be 2 or 3 Ian Paisleys in the province of Northern Ireland. One's enough.
Now, what are you trying to say? I'll stick my butt in your bollock.
No, I'm not trying to be funny, Dr. Paisley. It was a joke, really. So what do you think of this cloning business, that they can clone human beings as well as sheep?
Well, I remember when Dolly the sheep was cloned. All the Fenians down in South Armagh were very excited. One priest put an order in for a sheep with a 3-foot-long back legs and an arse like an otter boy. And they're all getting very excited down there. The thing is, however, the Fenians are nearly outbreeding us at the minute. While good Ulster Protestants only do it every time Rangers win, the Fenians are shagging away like Hughie Green on ecstasy. And speaking of Hughie Green, I sent Polly Yates a supportive message at Christmas. I wrote on the card, "Dear Paula, I'm sorry about all the bad news you've had recently, and I mean that most sincerely. P.S. I'm enclosing a Reverend William McCrea CD to remind you of Michael Hutchison. He sounds as though he's been strangled too. Anyway, I've done my bit for Ulster. Great strappy lads, Ian and Kyle, and Rhonda, a very, very fine artist. She said to me the other day she wanted to paint a nude, and I said, you're not bringing that fucker Sammy Wilson back into this house again. Well, hopefully, my Rhonda will soon settle down with a nice Christian gentleman and start procreating for Protestantism. That was a bit of a mouthful, though. Sorry about that. But anyway, in the meantime, we should start cloning Protestants. Now, what would be the ideal Protestant clone? What would he have? Well, he would have my sense of compromise. He would have David Trimble's composure, Bob McCartney's modesty, Jim Molyneux's sense of humour, and Willie McCrea's voice. Oh, yes. What a combination.
Right, well, I don't see that actually happening, Dr. Paisley. As for Jim Molyneux having a sense of humour, I think that's really...
Well, I know he doesn't have a fucking sense of humour. I wasn't being serious about that, Mr. Cole. Have you no fucking wit, no humour, son?
Right, now, let's get out. Now, Gerry Adams, you were saying about we don't like talking about sexually transmitted diseases, but I mean it does happen, and this country, of course, has went through the AIDS scare and all the rest of it. Gerry Adams, what have you got to say about it?
Well, since I started the peace process, I've been jetting all around the world, spreading the word of Sinn Féin. and you could say I had a ballot box in one hand and a Samsonite in the other. I have, however, spent most of my time in America, and I was over the moon when I got my visa, as you know. But I've got a MasterCard, an American Express, so, well, I keep, those in my inside pocket. I want everyone to keep buying the books or else. Anyway, while I was in America, I'm ashamed to say that I was unfaithful to the other half. I was at a $500 a plate Bobby Sands Memorial Dinner in Boston. And you could say I dined for Ireland. Well, this woman starts chatting me up. And eventually, she suggested that we move the process forward by going back to her room for all party talks. Now, the next day, I felt this terrible itch around my butt. On closer inspection, I found that my pubic hair was as occupied as the six counties. I thought, Jesus Christ, Teresa's going to kill me. If I go back there and give her the crabs, so I'll be in trouble. So I tried Dettol, Domestos, even Toilet Duck. And they haven't gone away, you know. The thing is, I haven't been near Teresa since. She's a bit suspicious. But I've told her that I have taken a vow of celibacy until we have an agreement on Stormont. She said that gives a new meaning to our day will come. So I've decommissioned my trouser snake until I find a cure.
Right now, gentlemen, come on now. Listen, now, Dr. Pizzi, very interestingly, I want to ask you a couple of questions that normally people wouldn't ask you. I want to ask you, the people of Northern Ireland, what they really, really want to know is, who's your favourite Spice Girl?
Oh, well, that's a very good question, Mr. Cole. You may be surprised, but I have a lot in common with the Spice Girls. The media keep writing us off as has-beens, but after every European election, just like the Spice Girls, I still make it to number one. Now, let's see who's my favourite. Sporty Spice. She's the ugly one that never gets her kit off. She reminds me too much of the Women's Coalition. And then we have Baby Spice. A bit young for me, but if I was a Roman Catholic priest, I might be tempted to attack. And then we have Scary Spice. No. The only black I'm into is a Royal Black Institution. Haven't missed a sham fight at Scarborough for years. Mind you, it's not as big a sham as what is going on at the Stormont Talks.
Right, well, what about your woman Posh Spice?
Oh, yes, she used to be my favourite, yes. Nice firm set of principles. And then I found out her real name was Victoria Adams. Well, I'm not about to get into negotiations with anyone called Adams. No, I'll tell you who my favourite is. It's Ginger Spice. I like her. Did you see her in her Union Jack dress? It reminded me of Orange Lil, except Ginger has a nice pair of tits, and her dress is about 3 foot shorter, so I'm into that. Eileen's a bit jealous, though. She said to me the other night, Ian, what are you doing beneath those sheets with that pitcher of Ginger Spice? Be careful or you'll lose your deposit, she said. No, Eileen, I said, I'm just about to top the pole again. But yes, we had a good laugh, and that's what it's about. So Messrs. Adams, Human, a herd. I tell you what I want, what I really, really want. I wanna stop you interfering with Ulster's internal constitutional affairs. So butt out, you Republican button rastards.
Blind Hate, the selection process.
Welcome to our special election edition of Blind Hate. Tonight's lucky lady in search of love is the former Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, Mo Mowlam. Tell me, Mo, what are you looking for in a man?
Well, woman, the things I'm looking for in a man include, firstly, a sense of humour, a keen intellectual mind, an ability to commit empathy, but most of all, a huge cock.
Well, let's hope the elections coming up result in a hung assembly, a really well hung assembly.
Oh, Robin, I wish I could top your poll this minute.
I'm sorry, Mo, but I do want to lose my deposit. But enough of this risque banter. Let's get down to the meat of the issue. We have three horny hunks here tonight, all desperate to whisk you away on our mystery trip to an exotic location. And they are...
Sorry, Graham can't be here to do this announcement, but I am his father, Zanjing. Number one is the biggest Willie in Stormont. This Randy Reverend is both a politician and a singer who specializes in country and gospel recordings. and I bet he's dying for you to get your hands on his extended 12-inch remix. So let's give it up for the Reverend William McCrea from Mid-Ulster, South Antrim, or wherever the fuck he's standing. Number 2 is Jerry Fit. Now he's a lord, he's dying to get his grubby hands all over your long, blonde hair. Peace. Number 3 is the duck with the cock. He thinks he's been dangled as he's the biggest orange man around, and he's desperate to squeeze his juices all over you.
Well, Mo, it looks like we've got 3 stoogies here for you tonight. What is your first question?
Well, what I would like to ask the contestants is whether they have bought my book, and I would like number 3 to answer that first.
Well, I can tell you, Mo, from the moment I picked up your book until the moment I put it down, I couldn't stop laughing. Someday I'll get round to reading it.
Cheeky bastard. Same question to number 2.
Well, of course I've read your book, Mo. I've caressed your spine with my fingers, lingered all over your opening chapter, and if I had my way, you definitely wouldn't be left on the shelf.
A real charmer, isn't he, Mo? With all this talk about spy scandals in Stormont, in your time in office here, were you ever worried about being penetrated by Sinn Féin?
Chance would be a fine thing, Elliot. And finally, the same question to number 3.
No, I have not read your book, Mo. I'm told it contains sex, drugs, bad language and graphic descriptions of republicanism in it. No, the only book I read is the good book.
So there you have it, Mo. Will you pick number 1, a big Willie who will take you up the country and western clubs? Number 2, the ever-hungry Lord Fitz who would like to loosen you up with a bottle of gin and give you a good tonic? Or will it be number 3, Ian Paisley, who will probably pull you out if he doesn't get to see your bunkers?
This is a very hard one.
You're telling me, Mo.
But I'm thinking I'm developing a soft spot for Willie.
Okay, Mo, but first, let's meet the contestants that you have rejected. Come in, number 2, Gerry Fit from Belfast.
Thank fuck you rejected me, you're brutal. I heard you got a waterbed for Christmas. You must have drank the fucking water out of it. You're a waterbed and 2 legs, nay.
But seeing you now, I'm just glad I rejected you. You remind me too much of that little prick who used to be in Winterghost.
And you've also turned down the Rev from Cypress Avenue. What a pity, he would never have said no to you.
Oh, so you're Mo Mowlam. I thought you were just a tea lady up at Stormont during the Good Friday negotiations. But I tell you what, you're a real stinker.
Well, you can just fuck off now. I've seen better looking goblins.
And here is your blind hate date. Yes, wee Willie McCrea from Macrofelt.
Christ, you're a bit squawny, aren't you? You can't weigh more than 120 pounds.
Yes, Mo, but 100 pounds of that is pure cock.
So who's going to choose the card with a mystery location for your date?
Well, you know me. I'm very traditional. When I'm with a lady, she always comes first.
Is that a promise, Willie? Okay, here goes. Oh, it's a weekend in Derry.
And where the fuck is Derry? Surely you mean Londonderry?
Whatever.
Well, these 2 lovebirds are going off to the Paris of the Northwest. Yes, Derry stroke Londonderry. When they come back from the Maiden City, we'll see if Mo is still a maiden and whether Willie has managed to lift any of the shirts that the women of the city are famous for making. Or will they go offside in the bogside? Will he have a queer gag in the Craigan? Or will the course of true love be foiled yet again? Watch this space.
Do you know, I've just found out why Derry is called the Maiden City. Apparently during the siege, the city walls were never penetrated by King James. I know just how he felt.
We're going over to the studio for McBlain Newsflash.
I know this is not a newsflash as such, but if you like Kylie Minogue like I do, the anagram of her name is You Like Minge.
Blind Hate, The Lover's Return.
Welcome back to the second part of our Blind Hate election special. Last week, Mo the Minger Mowlam chose wee Willie McCrea, and they set off for a romantic weekend in Derry stroke Londonderry. Let's see how they got on.
Well, here we are in Derry. Oh, sorry, Londonderry. What would you like to do first, Willie?
Would you like me to take you up the bogside?
Maybe later, Willie. But I'd rather do some sightseeing first.
Later on in the bogside.
Jesus, Mo. This is where all our taxes are going. Building new houses and community centres for Fenians.
Just shut the fuck up, Willie. Do you want to get a shot? Look, there's an advice centre. Let's go and see if we can get some tourist information.
And what can I do for you two? Is it a DLA claim? Or do you just want an e-job done on your neighbours? Fuck me, it's Mo Mowlam and Willie McCrea.
Christ, Mo, you baldy bollocks. It's one of those advice centres.
Come on and take a seat there, Willie. I hear you're always on the lookout for one. I'd like you to meet my colleague, Mitchell McLachlan. The man with the most monotonous voice in Ireland.
Well, I must tell you that I resent that description, Martin, and it may be true that my loquation is a bit sephoric, but I aspire to impress the populace, not with pointless verbosity, but with the lucidity of my cold, continuous disputations.
Fuck me, Mitchell. You must have eaten the same fucking dictionary as David Irvine. Wake up, Willie. He's fucking finished.
Holy shit, that McLachlan character makes Bob McCartney sound like that Martin Luther Van Dross character.
Oh, sorry, Martin, but I can't linger to chat. We've got to do some last searches of all the Sinn Féin voters who have been left off the electoral register. That's right, Mitchell. You don't think we've got all these copies of the Derry Journal's death notices for nothing? It used to be that the Brits interned Republicans. Now they're the victims of internment. That's right, Martin. We didn't march for one man, one vote, just so that the Brits could disenfranchise the nationalists just as soon as they expire. For some of our voters up in the city cemetery, haven't even started decomposing yet.
I tell you what, Mo, it's no wonder that bastard McGuinness took my seat. It was up against stiff opposition, literally.
Oh, never mind, Willie. Let's get back to the hotel before we run into John Hume. I'd rather have my bikini line waxed by John Prescott than having to listen to that fucker's single transferable speech again.
Let's ask our two blind haters how they got on during their weekend. Will I have to buy a new hat, or perhaps a balaclava and a beret?
First of all, I have to say that all was going really, really well until we got back to the hotel. Well, Willie, almost as soon as we went into her womb, committed an unspeakable act.
He didn't, did he? Tell us more.
Yes, the wee fucker got me to get down on my knees, and then he... Oh, it was horrible. He showed me this long, narrow tongue, and then he sang a fucking country and gospel song to me.
Jesus, no. How could you, Willie?
Well, she led me on. Don't get me wrong. I don't usually do country on a first date. But she's a temptress. She's a scarlet whore. And I just couldn't resist giving her a mouthful of sweet gospel music.
And if that wasn't enough, he then got his old mangy organ out and started fingering it for hours.
Oh, Willie.
That was no organ, Mo. That was my trusty old accordion. And I might have a knackered old box, much like yourself. But at least I can still squeeze a tune out of it.
Well, let's see if I can squeeze a tune out of you, you sanctimonious, wee, gurney, gospel, screeching, free, Presbyterian, preaching prick.
Oh, will you fucking do it, Mo? Let me have
a... Now you take that, you wee bastard.
I must say, it sounds better than his last record. But now that Mo has finally got her hands around a willy, it's time to leave you. Tune in next week when we have a lovely lass from Cluin Place who will be getting to choose from amongst three studs who live just a stone's throw away. Yes, quite literally, in the Short Strand.
How's about you? Von Mo Mowlam, how could she treat our Willie like that? I'm not political at all, but I do like the Reverend William McCrea's music. In the summertime, I like nothing more like putting a gerbil up my arse with its teeth and its nails pulled out. Oh, sorry, I beg your pardon, I went off the old bait and docket there. I like nothing more than putting one of his country and gospel CDs on the stereo and listening to him in the backyard. Although I do have the odd occasional complaint from the neighbours objecting to the sound of Willie coming out of my back passage.
Well, we're going back to the studio for a newsflash.
US and British forces have invaded a housing estate in Pakistan today. 250 are dead and 400 are injured. A spokesman says they will attack the second house tomorrow.